like you lost another one.
Well, happy Tuesday and welcome everyone to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me a bit of your most precious commodity, your time. Y'all do me a favor and please love up on Love Jones for me. And please make sure that you've liked the video on your way in and don't be afraid to drop in the chat box and say hello. If you enjoy yourself while you're here, please consider subscribing to the channel, making sure to click the notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on an opportunity to chill with us when the Speakeasy is open for business. Now, with that being said, welcome to all of my brand new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to the channel, and I hope that you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to the Speakeasy Backyardigans, who are my returning sippers and speakers, as well as those of you catching this on the replay. Thank each and every one of you for coming back one more time to love up on your girl, because I can't seem to get enough of the way that y'all love on me. I'm watching this thing, y'all, because y'all know we had some internet issues, but I am happy to report that after much cursing and acting a slap ass fool, we'll have that situation rectified in at least 12 days. So I'm happy about that. Well, that's 12 days from yesterday. So, yeah, we're going to get that taken care of now. So that's why I didn't come to y'all yesterday. That and child trying to make a decision. But now that we're all here, y'all got me? Let's get this thing started. All right. First things first, a little bit of housekeeping.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
Thank you, Summer, for the pre-show tip. She said, for you the best. Thank you so much, Summer. I appreciate you, and you the best too, boo. All right, now, let me see who's here with me so we can boogie on down the road, because we have two things to cover today, child. Listen. All right, so first sipper and speaker in the building, Hashitashi Grasshopper. Hey, learning. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. And thank you for sharing my channel to the security guard at your job. Hopefully she shows up and enjoys herself. And here we go. Happy Tuesday to my annoyingly wonderful little sister and moderator extraordinaire, Love Jones. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. And let me zip through this, child. Hey, Law, welcome, boo, and you too, Marva, and you too, Tanisha. Seti Said is in the building. Hey, Shakayla. Hey, sweet November. Glad you're here, darling. Hey, Michi. Welcome, welcome. Honestly, Kay is with us, along with Jasmine and Jan and Danielle. Tatiana Barrow, welcome. You're new. All right, she says she's been listening to so many replays. I feel like I know everyone already. Well, welcome. Y'all welcome Tatiana to the Speakeasy. Hey, Summer. Wait a minute, y'all. This thing is jumping up. I'm getting ready to click the next thing and it jumped way up. All right, there we go. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. And you too, Shikara, daughter of my brand new bestie. Welcome, welcome. Welcome, Nina. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Y'all welcome Nina to the Speakeasy. Hey, Miss Tiffany and Miss Pretty and Misha Lachey. Melly Mel is in the building along with Dee Reed and Shanae and Jazzy. Buns is in the building with us. I'm going. Michael Anderson is joining us again. Welcome, welcome. Hey, Karen Salter. Been a minute, boo, but welcome back. Thank you for being here. Hey, Sean. Welcome, welcome. Peanut. Hey, girl. Hey. Welcome, welcome. Demita G, welcome. Thank you for being here, lovey. And you too, mommy. Girl, where you been, child? I be seeing you on the replay comments. I'm happy that you're here for a live stream. So welcome. L Boogie's in the building. Welcome, boo. And you too, Naja. Welcome, welcome. Milan is here. I almost thought I had everybody along with Church Lady. Child, let's hope she stay out of trouble today. Bolivian Jones, you're new. Welcome, welcome. Y'all welcome Bolivian to the Speakeasy. Let me see here. Unisha's here. I think I got everybody. I'm going. Yep, I got everybody. All right, so let me get my timestamp, honey, so we can get into some things right quick. Okay. Today, we're reading You Left Me at the Altar and In Love with My Uber Driver, both by Tanisha Stewart. And the synopses read, For You Left Me at the Altar, Trina had spent the last 3 years in a perfect relationship with Brandon. Now, after planning the perfect wedding with the man of her dreams, everything she had hoped for their lives together was on the brink of coming true. That is, until the day of the wedding when a very important guest didn't arrive, the groom himself, Brandon. Now, Trina's left to pick up the pieces of her life and figure out what went wrong. Why did Brandon leave her at the altar after everything they had been through? Trina wants answers, and she won't rest until she finds them. Her heart won't let her. Okay? Now, that's for the first one. And the second one is In Love with My Uber Driver. Sylvia can't seem to get past her trifling ex, Jameer, or her traumatic vehicle accident that left her psychologically paralyzed. Dontrell is still stuck on his ex, Samaya. Both seem to be nowhere near ready to try something new, but when Dontrell ends up being Sylvia's Uber driver, their lanes begin to shift in another direction. So yeah, y'all, these were a couple of shorts by Tanisha, so I figured you know, why not? Let's knock them on off because they had been in the randomizer. So when one came up and it was so small, I was like, you know what? No, we about to kill two birds, one stone. All right. So we're going to start with you left me at the altar. And I got my first timestamp here. I hope y'all had a good Monday yesterday and you're having a good Tuesday today and that your week has not been too difficult, honey. Let me wet my whistle. And hopefully this thing will be cooperating with us today, honey, because ain't nobody got time for that. 3 days before, my mom paced back and forth in her living room. Are you completely sure you want to do this, Trina? I rolled my eyes. Yes, Mom, I said, for what felt like the umpteenth time. I don't know why she's always tripping. Brandon and I have been together 3 years. I just don't like the way he proposed. I had a flashback of that night. I'd been badgering him for months about where he thought our relationship might be going. He knew what I wanted, and I knew that he knew, but I didn't want to just come out and say it. When he finally did propose, the ring was a little smaller than I imagined it would be, but it was the thought that counted, right? Trina, Mom, why are you trying to sabotage my relationship? Why can't you just be happy for me? I stared at the picture of my father on the wall above my mom's TV set. I missed him so much. Mom saw me looking and followed my gaze. Her eyes welled with tears. Trina, it's not that I don't want you to be happy. I'm just concerned about whether this is the right decision. Well, we've been together 3 years. We've got to get married sometime. She shook her head. See, what you just said, that right there. She looked up at the picture of my father again, then back at me. Okay, Trina, if this is what you want to do, it is. And I want you to be happy for me. Okay. And that's the end of that chapter. So this is a psychological drama, y'all. And now... now we get into the meat of it. All right, so let me get this next timestamp, child. Who else came in here before I even boogie on down the road? Okay, Kaylin came in. Hey, girl. Hey, welcome, welcome. Hey, Missouri. Welcome, welcome. I think that's it, child. All right, nope. Naomi came in. Hey, boo. Welcome. All right. So here we go, y'all. Okay. This can't be real. Denial. I've been staring at this message for the past 2 days. My mind keeps going back and forth. On the one hand, I know what happened to me, but on the other hand, I can't believe it's true. I'm coming to you as a woman, was how she began. I thought it was a joke. Stuff like this only happened in movies. It only happened in books and in other people's lives, not mine. I'd already given half my savings toward this wedding. It was supposed to be a grand affair, white and fuchsia arrangements, a multicolored butterfly to pin to the side of my masterfully constructed petal bun. Everything was going to be perfect. Brandon and I have been together for over 4 years. When my eyes saw those words, my heart was pierced and I swallowed hard to choke down the urge to scream. Brandon and I had been seeing each other for 3 years. I was effectively the side chick. She wrote more, but I didn't want to read it. That first sentence was enough to make me want to just laugh it off and send her a petty reply, but I forced myself to read more. I don't know what it is that you think you have going on with my man, but it needs to stop today. Brandon and I are moving forward and we don't need any drama in our lives. Moving forward, what was this chick on? She wasn't the one walking down the aisle in a week. I was. I closed out my inbox without bothering to respond. Women always get jealous when they find out you're getting married, I breathed, then flipped my hair and went about the rest of my day. I held my head high and filled my week with the busyness of preparing, arranging, and finalizing all the last-minute details. Time went by in a blur. Nothing could have prepared me for that Saturday morning. When we arrived at the church, me and all my girls were getting slayed, reminiscing about the fun we had at my bachelorette party, celebrating my last night as a free woman. My wedding day started off without a hitch, and then it happened. Oh, Lord, there's a break in the chapter, y'all. So now we get to it. This was the day I had waited and hoped for my entire life. I was about to be married to the man of my dreams. I stood in front of the full-length mirror, giving myself a once-over for what felt like the 50th time in an hour. Girl, you really need to stop. You're making me dizzy. Charmaine took another sip from her wine glass. She insisted that she have something to calm her nerves, as if it was her wedding day and not mine. I was a trembling bundle of accents myself, though I forbade my body and voice from showing it. I just knew that this would be the happiest day of my life. Everything was planned down to the tiniest detail. Our family and friends had been seated, and the bridesmaids and groomsmen were in place, ready to take their cue. The only person we were waiting on was my groom. Brandon had claimed an hour ago that he got a flat tire on his way to the church. I believed him at first, but as time wore on, a pervading thought floated to the surface of my mind. Isn't this supposed to be the other way around? Usually, it was the bride who showed up late to her wedding, not the groom. I shook it off. I just couldn't think about that right now without freaking out. Brandon had never been the most punctual person anyway. It wasn't until the second hour of waiting that my heart began to sink. I had gone over my vows for the zillionth time. I'd paced back and forth so much that I'm sure my heels had worn a permanent path in the carpet. I had taken them off to rest my feet and put them back on so many times that I no longer kept count. My bladder was completely empty. My sweat glands were devoid of fluid. My breath gave off the scent of a mint factory, and my makeup would make social media filters take a walk of shame. Then I got the text message that turned my world upside down and snatched my heart directly out of my chest. Hey, I'm not going to be able to make it. Nigga. A text message, Brandon. My fingers reflexively swiped the screen and tapped his name in my contacts. He must have been in a no service area because the call went straight to voicemail. I tried again and it still didn't go through. The blood drained from my face and I shot up out of my seat so fast that I almost tripped on my wedding gown. What's wrong? Sydney was the first to notice. I can't believe this, I shrieked. Brandon said he's not coming. My voice reached an octave that was barely recognizable. What do you mean he's not coming? Charmaine slapped her drink down on the table and stood up with me. He said he's not coming, I repeated. My mind confused my words as if I was suddenly speaking a foreign language. I panted for breath and grasped the back of a chair to steady myself. Charmaine reached out to comfort me, and in that moment, I got another text from Brandon. I'm sorry it had to be this way, but I've decided to move on. Mom popped her head in the door. Trina, has Brandon contacted you? I don't know why my stupid fingers didn't learn the first time. I tapped the call button and held the phone to my ear, only to hear his voicemail once again. Yes, I did this again and again. By the fourth time, it felt like the room was spinning, and I threw the phone against the wall to make everything stay in place. I don't know how I got home or out of my dress. All I remember after that was waking up the next morning and feeling for Brandon, but he wasn't there. And it's another break in the chapter. Child, listen. Oh, Lord have mercy. I was on vacation because I would have been on my honeymoon if my world hadn't turned upside down, but I was spending a lot of time indoors binge watching and eating too much to numb the pain. There was no way I could face the outside world. Not this soon. As if my circumstances hadn't already demonstrated to me that life was dead set against me, I heard a knock on my front door. After a few moments of trying to ignore someone's persistent knocking, I finally gave in. Hold on, I huffed. I forced myself to stand up and willed my legs to position themselves one in front of the other until I was at the door. My hand paused on the doorknob, my mind contemplating whether I should open it. They probably sensed me standing here on the other side anyway, I muttered, and twisted the top lock, then the bottom. Finally, I popped open the door, and as soon as I did, I wished I hadn't. It was too late now. On my front porch stood my best guy friend, Anton, and my girls, Sydney, Malia, and Charmaine. Trina, Anton started. He gave me a long assessing look. Are you okay? What do you think? I snapped at no one in particular, then opened the door wider and went to the living room. I heard their footsteps as they followed me. I draped myself on the love seat and stared in their direction as they sat on the couch across from me. I couldn't bring myself to meet their eyes. Malia started, Trina, we tried to give you your space, but you haven't been answering any of our calls. I glanced at her, then looked away. We just want to be here for you, said Sydney. My eyes met hers. Her pupils shifted back and forth like they always did when she felt nervous. I knew her too well for her to hide that from me. There was something she wasn't saying. I opened my mouth to question her, but Charmaine cut in. Girl, I know it's hard, but you'll get through this. Thanks. My tone was flat, but I knew Charmaine understood. Anton had been staring at me the entire time. My jaw clenched, but my heart warmed. I finally mustered up the strength to meet his eyes. Can you please not do that? Do what? His gaze didn't lessen in intensity. You guys are making me feel like some kind of basket case. I stood up, suddenly needing to move. Well, what do you expect when you haven't been responding? Charmaine snapped back, her gaze following me as I paced back and forth. I paused and looked at her. What else was I supposed to do? I get it, but you're not about to let this man destroy your spirit. I felt the tears rise before they began to fall. Can you all just leave? I croaked. I never knew Brandon could make me feel this way. Up until Saturday, I was happily in love, so hopeful about our future together. But in the past 2 days, I had experienced emotions I didn't know how to describe. We don't have to, Anton began, but I held up my hand to stop him. I just need to be alone. I just stood there numb as each one wrapped their arms around me and murmured words of encouragement, then filed out the door. Anton was the last to go. He stood in front of me with open arms, his stocky frame beckoning me to step into his comforting embrace. I ignored him, tearing my focus away from his welcoming stance. I gazed out the window until I heard him softly close the door behind him. Finally, I was able to look at the safe and solid barrier between my raw emotions and my caring friends who meant well, but whose help I just couldn't cope with right now. I shuffled back to the love seat and eased down into the cushions, as if it would somehow alleviate the stabbing pain in my heart. I glanced at my phone again, my thoughts going back to that message from India, the woman who was apparently his girlfriend. My brain had processed that message so many times by now that I probably had it memorized. No need to antagonize my eyes by reading it again. Another break, child. It's been almost a week, and I've relived that day in my dreams ever since. I can't shake the memory, no matter how hard I try. I think my mind is trying to find a way to make it all go away. That didn't really happen to me, did it? I've steered clear of my inbox and all forms of social media ever since the so-called intervention with Anton, Malia, Charmaine, and Sydney, but I've at least answered their phone calls and texts. I kept the conversations brief because I still don't want to be bothered. Sydney and I still need to have a one-on-one. There's something she isn't telling me, and I know it. When she was at my house, in between my attempts to avoid all of their eyes, I noticed that she was trying to avoid mine. What's her deal? Does she know something I don't know? And then there's my mother to deal with. At some point, I'm going to have to face her. Mom never liked Brandon and never wasted an opportunity to tell me so. In her eyes, he was never good enough, and she couldn't see us lasting forever. I guess she was right. She thinks she's always right, but why did she have to be right this time? My thoughts are all over the place. One part of me longs for this to be a bad dream so I can wake up and never have to experience it again. The other part of me is reaching out and trying to touch it to make it tangible so I can know for sure that what happened was real. I haven't left the house yet. I can't face the rest of the world. After another agonizing day, I finally decided to take a peek at my social media. I felt like a total lame for doing so, but I knew that by now everyone had to have known what happened, so I was fishing for sympathy posts. Worst decision of my life. I'd barely been online for 5 seconds before I saw the photos. Wedding photos. My heart literally stopped and my breath caught in my throat. My eyes were playing tricks on me. That wasn't Brandon, and that for sure couldn't be India. Hand in hand, smiling, white dress, black tux. It pained me to do so, but I scrolled even further. What I saw next caused my finger to pause mid-swipe. It was an ultrasound. They were having twins. He was going to marry her the whole time. He was never going to marry me. She was his woman. I was nothing more than a side chick. All of the numbness and indiscernible emotion faded, and in its place, a cold, steel ball of rage rose up within me. Oh, it was time for retribution. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Okay, I knew Tanisha Stewart wasn't going to let us down, baby. So this one here started off with a bang, child. Oh, thank God this is a short because I couldn't read a whole book like this. the way I would be shooting up the whole fucking world. Y'all do not even realize. Let me get this next time stamp, child. Now, we wouldn't be able to get through a whole book, like a full-size book. Did anybody come in, child? All right, I think I got everybody, honey. I just be wanting to make sure I spoke to everybody. Okay, all right. Okay, y'all. Oh, shit. Sorry, I missed that. I'm sorry.
Hold on. Here comes the money.
Here we go. Money talk.
Here comes the money.
Thank you, petty ass law, for the tip. She said for taking part in the Backyard Chaos Sunday. Okay, yes. A mess. Y'all ain't shit, boy. Hello, Christina Carter. Welcome. Y'all welcome Christina to the Speakeasy. Yeah, I do too, Shakara. She's real good. I think I've read maybe one of her things over here, but I've read several, child, in my bathtub, okay? Stay out my business. I just like this lady's books. So, yes, I have to get on down and give her props because, yeah, she handles up on her business. She definitely, definitely does that. Oh, my God.
Comes the money.
Here we go. Money talk.
Here comes the money.
Money, money,
money.
It's fast. It's breaking down already. Thank you, Seti said, for the tip. She said, for reading a book that came out swinging and on fire. Okay? Abso-fucking-lutely, okay? I'm like, what the hell? Yeah, she didn't come to play. She did not come to play. All right, so now let me get on back to this here. And thank y'all for y'all patience, but y'all already know how it is over here, so we ain't even tripping. How dare he? Anger. I sat at my kitchen table contemplating my next move as if he knew the direction my mind was going. Anton called. Trina, how are you? Fine. He sighed. No, you not. I can hear it in your voice. Then why did you even ask, Anton? Look, if you need to talk, you know I'm here for you. I don't need to talk. I need a drink. I need a time machine. Trina, I'm sorry this happened to you. Mm-hmm. I suddenly became interested in the number of specks on the surface of my wooden table. Have you been on social media today? I perked up. Why? He drew out his response. Nothing. Just asking. I saw it. I wiped an imaginary smudge off the tabletop. How much did you see? All of it. Trina. Chill, Anton. I'm gonna be okay. Isn't that what all of you keep telling me? I'm coming over. No, I blurted. I really just need time to process all of this. But isolating yourself is not healthy. I'm not isolating. Haven't I been answering all of your messages? I just need to see you. Tomorrow. I have to do something tonight. As soon as I said those words, I knew I had said too much. What do you have to do? Suspicion was evident in his tone. Nothing. Look, I have another call coming in. I'll talk to you later. Trina, I hung up and plopped the phone onto the table before I could allow him to convince me not to go through with my plan. I needed to see Brandon. As I drove to Brandon's house, I questioned my decision to take this trip at midnight and exactly why I needed a baseball bat and a butcher knife to accompany me. It's just for protection, I murmured. From what? I argued with myself, but I ignored the voice of reason. It was time for retribution. I parked on the street in front of his house and grabbed the bat and knife before hopping out of the car. I tucked the knife in my back pocket, don't ask, and took a few steps toward Brandon's front porch when I stopped and stared in shock at what I saw in the driveway. Apparently, the newlyweds had quite the wealthy guest list, or maybe they had been saving for this day. Parked side by side were two convertibles, one royal blue and one hot pink. Both had vanity plates, literally his and hers. I wanted to vomit. I fought to maintain my composure as I approached Brandon's vehicle. So this is what we're doing, I asked, as if the convertible could respond. Before I knew it, the bat was smashing against the back bumper of Brandon's car. The alarm was sounding, and I saw lights from neighbors' houses flipping on as I broke out in a cold sweat. Brandon emerged from his house, rubbing his eyes. Trina, what are you doing here? When he saw the bat in my hand, he started toward me. No, stay away. I wielded the bat in his direction, forcing him to keep his distance. He was clearly at a loss for words. Look, I didn't know how to tell you. India appeared in the doorway of the house. When she saw me, her jaw dropped. What are you doing here? She looked at Brandon. Baby, what is this? Trina, you need to go, Brandon warned me with his eyes. There better not be a dent in that car. India stormed off of the porch, but I whipped out the knife with my free hand, effectively stopping her in her tracks. Both of their eyes widened. You're crazy, India screeched. Bae, go in the house. Brandon stepped in front of her to protect her. Trina, he repeated, you need to go. My heart panged at the fact that he was protecting her like she was his woman. Wait a minute, she was. She was his wife, and I was the woman scorned. I took a step back and felt my ankle pop, and I lost my footing on the edge of the curb. My anger rose within me, and in one swift motion, I plunged the knife into Brandon's driver's side rear tire. Trina! There was fire in his eyes, but it couldn't match the fury in mine. I heard sirens in the distance, so I wrenched the knife from his tire and limped over to my vehicle. I threw the knife and bat on the front passenger seat and peeled off before the cops arrived. I turned down a random street and pulled to the side of the road where I threw the car in park, tossed the knife and bat down a storm drain and peeled off again. What is this, some kind of action movie? My mind screamed as my sense of rationalism finally returned. What did I just do? Oh God, I am in so much trouble. I covered my mouth with my hand as I pulled into my driveway. At that point, I realized that the sirens were approaching my house. I waited for the police officers to arrive, then calmly surrendered when they asked me to step out of my vehicle. I've never been more humiliated in my entire life. After the demeaning set of procedures at the jail, the strip search, fingerprints, and booking, I found myself in a holding cell. Luckily, I was alone, and I breathed a praise to God when I was informed that Anton had come to bail me out. It was my first offense, and apparently Brandon and India told the officers they didn't want to press charges, so I was a free woman as long as I made my court date. I don't even know how to feel. Thank you, Anton. I wiped the single tear that rolled down my cheek. I was so glad he came to get me. I didn't want to deal with my mom, and I didn't want to answer a barrage of questions from Charmaine or Malia. Plus, Sydney was still on my radar. He didn't respond. I'll pay you back if you want. It sounded more like a question than a statement. I knew him so well, and his stony expression told me he was really pissed at me. He sighed. This is why I tried to talk to you, Trina. I looked down at my shirt. I know. We have to get you out of this house, but in the meantime, I'm spending the night, or at least the rest of it. He reached in the back seat and grabbed his overnight bag. I was so out of it that I hadn't noticed it when I got in the car. That's fair, I responded. It wasn't like I had much of a choice anyway. I flicked the light on when we entered my house. Brandon closed the door behind us and headed to the living room. Not Brandon, I think she meant Anton. Because when the fuck did Brandon get there? But it says Brandon. So Anton closed the door behind us and headed to the living room. He plopped down on the couch and set his bag on the floor beside him. I brushed a strand of hair behind my ear. I'll get you a blanket. Thanks. When I returned with the blanket, he gently grabbed my hand before I could walk away. Trina, we really need to talk about what happened tonight. My eyes blurred with tears. Not tonight, Anton. I've got enough to process about today as it is. Why don't you let me help you process it? It's too painful. It almost hurt to even say those words. You can be vulnerable with me. I finally met his eyes and I saw the sincerity in them, but I still wasn't ready. Tomorrow. With that, I went to my bedroom and felt his gaze follow me with each step I took. And there's a break in the chapter. I heard my curtain open and sunlight fill the room. Mom? I quickly sat up in bed, shielding my eyes from the brightness. What are you doing here? Girl, it's been almost a week. I waited for you to come to me, but you didn't, so I'm here. Anton let you in? I'm gonna kill him, I thought. Is that a problem? She placed her hand on her hip. Mom, I just need time alone. Well, you might get a whole lot of that if they decide to charge you with a felony. What are you talking about? I know he didn't tell her I got arrested. She sat on the edge of my bed. My friend Sabrina's daughter, Brittany, works at the jail. She's the one that booked you. So that's why she looked familiar. This only added to my humiliation. Mom, it was horrible. What you did was horrible. You know I raised you better than that. I don't know what I was thinking. You weren't thinking. That's the problem. My ears burned at the truth of her words. She placed her hand on my wrist and took a more gentle approach. Trina, what that boy did was foul, but you can't let him take you out of character. I know he hurt you deeply, but allowing yourself to get criminal charges on your record is not worth it. I wiped a tear. You really think they'll give me jail time? Probably not. It was your first offense. I spoke with a lawyer this morning. Sabrina referred him. I can only imagine what people are saying about me. What people think doesn't matter. What matters is that you don't allow this situation to make you feel any less of yourself. I didn't want to keep talking about me. Is Anton still asleep? She looked at me like she knew I was evading her. He said he was running to the store to get some stuff for breakfast. Just then, we heard a knock on the front door. Thank God. I got up and went into my bathroom to take a quick shower and fix my hair as my mother answered the door for Anton. Pretty soon, my mouth began to water as I smelled the sweet and savory aromas of strawberry banana pancakes, Italian sausage, and grits. When I got to the kitchen, I smiled when I saw that my plate was waiting for me on the table. Anton and Mom had already dug in. Girl, this boy can cook, Mom said between bites. I've never tasted a pancake that made me want to smack my mama. Anton chuckled and almost choked on his pancake. Mom clapped his back and he took a gulp of orange juice to wash his food down. I sat across from him and took a bite of my own pancake. Ooh, I see what the hype is about. Mom was right. Anton had created the perfect blend of butter, sweetness, and crispy edges. My fork barely left my mouth before I wanted another bite. Well, thank you, said Anton, and he stood to take a bow. While he was up, he put the last of the pancakes on a plate and brought them to the table. That's what you need. Mom pursed her lips and cocked her head in Anton's direction, giving me a knowing look. I felt myself heating up. Mom, we'd had this conversation a million times. Anton and I were just friends, nothing more. Mom could never understand that. And there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. After Anton went to work and Mom left to run errands, I watched a Kevin Hart stand-up to keep my mind off of Brandon and India. Eventually, my phone rang and I allowed Malia to convince me to go out to dinner with her, Charmaine, and Sydney that night. I didn't really want to go, but I figured I couldn't diss them after spending the morning with Mom and Anton. Plus, I had to tell them about last night's incident. You did what? Charmaine exclaimed. Both Sydney and Malia's jaws dropped. I don't know what came over me, guys, I said in a small voice. I hope they don't give you any serious charges. Malia looked so worried for me. Thank you. I took another sip. This sangria was hitting, and I was feeling kind of nice. So you go back to work tomorrow, huh? Said Charmaine. Yep. Just thinking about work was a buzzkill. I wasn't looking forward to that place with everyone saying congratulations, only for me to have to tell them that I was stood up at the altar. Girl, don't even worry about it. Malia covered my hand with hers. That's much easier said than done. I took a glance at Sydney, who had been silent for most of the meal. How's your steak? I nodded toward her plate. She'd barely touched her food. Oh, it's fine. She cut a small piece and stuffed it into her mouth for good measure. Yep, she's hiding something. So why don't you just come out and say it, Sydney? She froze, her knife and fork poised above her plate. Say what? You've been kind of distant since the wedding. What's going on? Her face reddened. I don't know what you're talking about. Sydney, don't play with me. Charmaine cut in. Trina, you a little tipsy. And Sydney's a little untruthful. Malia tried to help. Maybe we should do this another time. That caught me off guard. You're in on this too? Nobody's in on anything, Sydney said. I ignored her. What is it, Malia? Tell me. You know I know something's going on. Malia looked at Charmaine with a desperate plea in her eyes, then Sydney. Charmaine looked confused. Sydney looked guilty. Look, I just found out yesterday, okay? Malia's voice was barely above a whisper. I set my fork down with a loud clatter. I'm gonna need you all to stop beating around the bush and just say what's on your mind. I'm tired of talking in circles. I'm not following, said Charmaine. I stared at Sydney and Malia. Malia broke first. Sydney told me yesterday that she kind of knew about Brandon and India. My heart dropped. My eyes shot to Sydney. What do you mean you knew? How long did you know he was cheating on me? I found out about a month ago. Charmaine and I blinked at the same time. You knew for a month? I shrieked, and the couple at the next table scowled at me. I glared at them. You got a problem with me? I wanted to shout, but I kept my cool. They were suddenly interested in their food again. Why didn't you say anything? Charmaine said to Sydney. Sydney looked at Malia, then back at me. I didn't know how to bring it up, Trina. I mean, how does somebody break that kind of news? I snapped. How about before my freaking wedding, before I got all dressed and dolled up and waited for over 2 hours for him to show up at the church? Malia appeared to be on the brink of tears. Charmaine's expression was unreadable. Trina, I'm so sorry, Sydney pleaded. No, don't come at me with that right now, Sydney. I stood up and leaned forward, toward her, and she inched back in her seat. How you gonna call yourself one of my best friends and contribute to the worst day of my life? Charmaine tried to grab my arm, but I wrenched out of her grasp. No, Charmaine, how could she do something like that? How about we take this outside? Charmaine urged. Other patrons were starting to stare, and the nosy couple was full on listening by this point, enjoying the drama. We don't need to fight. Malia's desperation was evident as she glanced back and forth between me and Sydney. I don't care about them. I flailed my arm. The only thing I need to know is how you could fix yourself to sit at this table and break bread with me after what you did. Sydney didn't respond. She just sat there and actually looked afraid of me. That only fueled my rage. I quickly grabbed my glass from the table and flung its contents in her direction, effectively dousing her with the rest of my sangria. I heard gasps around the room, but I didn't care. I stalked out of the restaurant with Charmaine hot on my heels. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, the way I would have hopped across that fucking table and been in that bitch face like a fucking spider monkey, you got me fucked up. You supposed to be my friend and you done sat your liver-lipped ass over there knowing for a whole fucking month that this nigga had another bitch? And you stood there while I got dressed and got my hair done and my makeup done, and you still ain't say shit. You a frowsy-ass, raggedy-ass, smarmy-ass, Gargamel-ass bitch. Oh, my God, today. Child, some of these hoes in this world ain't worth a hot, stinky fart out of a fat, constipated baby's funky ass. I promise. Just fuck all these people. Anyway, let me see if anybody else came in here, child, before we go on down the road. Where am I here? Who did I see? Oh, hey, Dior. Uh-oh, she done took her and put her picture up here. Hey, girl, hey. Welcome back, darling. I appreciate you being here. I almost didn't recognize you. I'm like, who the fuck is this? But that's you. I'm used to a purple avatar with a white D in it. That sounded real wrong, but you know what I'm saying. Not a white D, but the letter D. Buck, who likes to fuck? Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Did I miss anybody else? I got Misha. I think I got everybody, child. And Sadie said done changed her picture. I don't know who the fuck told her she could change her picture, but okay, child, because I almost didn't even, But I'm glad everybody's got a picture now. Well, pretty much. Some people don't. Like, anyway, it don't matter. Some people don't. Wait a minute. Did I miss Wifey? Hey, girl. Hey, I think I said hey to you, didn't I? Ain't it? Didn't I say hi to you, child? I don't know. Anyway, whatever. If I missed your shit, say something else. Let me get this next timestamp because I'm focused on this book, child. I do not believe this shit. That's supposed to be her friend. I told y'all. Y'all be thinking I be talking shit just to be saying shit. But these hoes do not be y'all fucking friends. I promise you. All right. So here we go with the next chapter. Why not me? Bargaining. I took the scenic route to work, fuming the whole way there. I rejected the 10th call from Sydney on my Bluetooth. She's crazy if she thinks we're still friends. How am I going to get through this day? I sighed as I traveled down the winding side road to the company parking lot. I worked as a data entry specialist at a research firm. It wasn't the most riveting career, but hey, it paid the bills. My main concern today was how I was going to effectively avoid my coworkers before I made it to my desk. Once I got there, it would be easy to tune them out. The company was pretty lax. They let us use our headphones as long as we kept our error rate to a minimum. I parked my car and took a deep breath. Just get through the day, Trina. Keep your eyes low. Stay focused. I grabbed my purse, ensured that my headphones and iPad were safely tucked into it, and made my way to the front doors of the building. Once I got inside, I was greeted by the security guard, Ralph. "Hey, Ralph," I managed a fake smile. "Hey, Trina, good to see you." His smile was genuine, but expectant. I wasn't sure how to proceed. Before he could ask me about my honeymoon, I gave him a little wave and started toward my desk. I made it down the long hallway without encountering any of my coworkers. I guess it pays to get to work early. As soon as I sat at my desk, someone spoke behind me and startled me. "Looky here at Mrs. Bougie." I swiveled in my chair to face Tasha. She sashayed over to me. "Hey," I said, and offered her the same fake smile I gave Ralph. "What you acting brand new because you married now?" She assessed me with her eyes, then frowned. "Girl, where's your ring?" My cheeks tinged with embarrassment. I wrestled with lying to her and telling her I left it at home, but I knew that would end up backfiring on me. I looked down at my shirt. "The wedding didn't happen," I mumbled. "What? Girl, what happened? Are you okay?" The fact that she was sincere only made it worse. I couldn't bear to meet her eyes. I sniffled before the first tear fell. "Listen, Tasha," I trembled as I stood up, fumbling for my purse. "Can you let Lacey know I had to take a personal day?" "Of course," she reached out for me. "Trina, I'm so sorry." That did it. I broke down, sobbing into her shirt. She held me tight and rubbed my back as my shoulders heaved. "It's gonna be okay, Trina. It's gonna be okay. Why did this have to happen to me?" I could barely get the words out, but that question had been burning in my heart ever since my non-wedding day. Wait a minute, not her non-wedding day, y'all. "And Trina, sometimes things happen that we don't understand, but this is going to work out for your good. You hear me?" I nodded. I really wanted to believe her. I truly did. Thankfully, we were so early that no one else was there yet, and Lacey, our supervisor, was in her office with the door closed. Tasha walked me out of the building and back to my car, promising that she would fill Lacey in on what happened. I thanked her profusely before driving off. And there's a little break in the chapter. Child, listen. Hey, Shanae, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Somehow, I ended up at the car dealership where Brandon worked. I pulled up next to his convertible in the customer and employee parking lot. My heart panged, but I couldn't resist a smug little smile when I saw that the dents I put in his car was still there. "How you like that?" I smirked as I recalled that night. I would likely have to pay to get them fixed, but a part of me felt like it was worth it. I sat there for a very long time, waiting for what? I was about to admit that I was a delusional stalker when I saw Brandon emerge from the building. He walked straight toward me. He always looked good in his business attire. He was a salesman at the dealership and one of the best on his team. I got out of my car and approached him before he could take another step. "Look, you know this is harassment, right?" he said. "We already didn't press charges. What more do you want? How dare you talk to me like that when you left me at the altar with no explanation?" He stepped closer and lowered his voice. "Trina, I wanted to tell you, but I didn't know how. 4 years, Brandon. You were with her for 4 years, and with me the last three." My voice went up an octave. "I wanted to tell you," he repeated. But what, Brandon? I find out I'm your side chick on our wedding day? Then you marry her the same weekend, and I find out she's pregnant with twins. How could you do this to me?" "I'm sorry. Did I mean anything to you? Anything at all?" "Of course you did. Why would you string me along and let me think we were getting married? I was booking venues, buying dresses. My whole family was there, Brandon. You know how humiliating that was? Do you know how much time and money was wasted?" "I didn't mean to hurt you." "Well, you sure as hell did." We held a staring contest for a long, agonizing moment. "Oh, come on, Brandon, talk to me. What do you see in her that you don't see in me?" "What do you mean? Why wasn't I good enough for you?" "It wasn't that you weren't good enough. I was with her when I met you. You know, the relationship between you and me just sort of happened." I took a step back from him, stung by his words. "So that's what I was to you? Just something that sort of happened?" He didn't respond. My mind was swimming. "Listen, we can make this right. Come back to me. I know she's pregnant, but we can work out payment arrangements for child support." I took a step toward him and continued my plea, the words coming out faster than my mind had time to process them. "You can annul the marriage. I think they give you that option if you haven't been married for long. Please, Brandon, let's just start over. I know that being saddled with India and two kids isn't what you want. Whatever I did, I'm sorry, but we can make this work." The expression on Brandon's face was indiscernible. After his silence became embarrassing, I tried again. Brandon, what do you think about that? You think we can try it again? I reached toward him, but he leaned back out of my grasp. Brandon? I sounded pathetic, even to my own ears. He clicked his key fob to unlock his door. Trina, listen, he said, facing me again. I'm sorry about what happened, but I can't change the past. Maybe you can get counseling or something, but there's nothing I can do for you. With those words, he got in his car, put on a seatbelt, turned the key in the ignition, and backed out of his parking space. My eyes remained glued to his license plate until his car was out of sight. And there's a break in the chapter. You know what? That's what small claims court is for. You take the nigga to small claims court, get your money back that you spent on the wedding because he was a philandering ass, cheating ass, cupcaking ass nigga, and then you go on about your life. Find you somebody else. But girl, but I understand her pain, right? She's hurt. She's absolutely hurt. My next stop was Mom's house. She was retired from her career as a corrections officer, so she was likely either gardening or sipping tea while watching her soaps. I knocked on her door and waited for her pattering feet to answer it. After standing there for what felt like an eternity, I decided to just let myself in with my key. I slipped off my shoes so I wouldn't mess up her clean, fluffy carpet. As I walked down the hallway towards Mom's living room, I glanced at all the photos of me on the wall. I was an only child. Mom said she only had enough sanity for one kid. I chuckled, then paused at the picture of me and my dad. We lost him to cancer when I was four, and neither of us had fully moved on since. Does anyone ever fully move on? I sighed and entered the living room. Sure enough, Mom was sitting there, eyes glued to the screen, sipping her tea and watching The Young and the Restless. The corners of my mouth briefly turned up when I saw that she was using one of the new teacups that I bought her for her 57th birthday. It took forever to get her to change anything, even things as simple as a teacup, since Dad passed away. It was almost as if she felt like having or doing anything new would make her lose all traces of him forever. She must have seen me enter the room out of the corner of her eye because she flinched and whipped her head in my direction. Girl, you trying to give your mama a heart attack? She rubbed her neck. Must have moved too fast, she remarked. She put her tea on an end table and stood up to give me a hug. I didn't mean to scare you, but I stood outside knocking forever. I sat down beside her as she reached for the remote to mute her show. Girl, I keep telling you, those soft knocks ain't doing nothing with my hearing. You need to bang on that door like you the police. I winced at the mention of the police. She noticed my discomfort. Aren't you supposed to be at work? They didn't fire you, did they? I tried to piece my words together. My mind was still reeling from my encounter with Brandon, and I hadn't even considered how my incident at his house could potentially affect my career. Wait a minute. It couldn't, right? No, I don't think they know about it, or at least I hope they don't. Wait, I didn't make the news or anything, did I? No, I didn't see you in the paper or on TV. We both paused. I think I'm safe then. Well, at least from that. Agreed. She crossed her arms. So what brings you here? What happened at work? Brandon happened. Brandon? What are you talking about? I looked down at my shirt. I couldn't stay at my job, so I took a personal day. I ended up at Brandon's job. I parked next to him and waited until he came out for his lunch break. Mom's expression was empathetic. Trina, I never should have gone there, Mom. My voice was small. He made me feel like nothing. Nothing. Mom looked heated now. Let me get my tennis shoes. That boy ain't about to make my child crazy. She jumped up from her seat, ready for action. Mom, I reached out for her. I stared down at her bare feet and noticed her periwinkle pedicure with little white and silver flower designs on each big toe. Cute, I thought. Then I returned my attention to the matter at hand. Don't try to go there. It'll only make things worse. Well, what did he say to you? Standing over me, she lifted my chin so that I had to look up at her. What did he do? Can you sit down? Okay, but you need to talk to me, Trina. She sat down next to me. Where did you go for your pedicure? Girl, I got this done last week. Back to Brandon. What did he do to you? You never get designs on your toes. Stop deflecting. What did Brandon say? He said that our relationship was something that sort of happened. His exact words. There. Happy now? My face and neck heated up. The fire in my mother's eyes likely matched the shade of red that my skin had turned. She took a deep breath. Now you see why I never liked him. I looked down at my shirt again. Yep. Trina, I'm not trying to make you feel any worse than you already do, but I do need to ask you this as your mother. Didn't you notice the signs? I finally met her eyes again. Signs? Deep down in our hearts, every woman knows something must have told you he was cheating. I was feeling more and more embarrassed by the moment. I mean, yeah, there were women who would be in my inbox throughout our relationship, but it was only proven once that he actually cheated. The others were just haters. She crossed her arms. And what did you do the one time he did cheat? I thought back to that day. It was some random chick named Rebecca. I thought she totally wasn't his type, but then she sent me some screenshots. I was devastated. Why do you believe you stayed with him even after knowing that he cheated? The heat in that room had to have been on at least 80. This conversation was causing me to work up a sweat. I smoothed out a wrinkle in my skirt. He said he was sorry and I didn't want to lose him. And what about the girl India, the one he married? Did she ever come to you? My mother should have been some kind of prosecutor. She completely missed her calling. Yes, she did? Her eyes widened in surprise. A week before the wedding, I mumbled. Then why did you go through with it? I thought she was just one of the haters, Mom. Can we talk about something else? She paused. Okay, I can see you're getting upset. She glanced at the clock on the wall across the room. So has Mr. Anton been by your house again? Why are you looking at the clock? Do you have somewhere to go? Well, yes, if you must know, I have a date. Great. Even my mother has a man now and nobody wants me. I felt even worse than I did before I came over. But I can cancel it if you want to spend the day together, she hastened to add. Regardless of what's going on in my life, you come first. That warmed my heart, but this whole date thing threw me off. Who are you going on a date with? When did you get a boyfriend? She blushed. I stared in amazement. This was completely unlike my mother. I literally had never seen her blush before. I wouldn't say he's my boyfriend, but I do think he's cute. It was her turn to act nervous. She grabbed a cushion from the couch, fluffed it for no reason, and put it back in its place. Cute? My jaw dropped. My life's troubles were temporarily forgotten as I was swept up in intrigue over Mom's new boo. Who are you, and what have you done with my mother? I touched her arm as if I was trying to ensure that she was actually real. Girl, stop that plan. It's not that serious. Who is it? Deacon James down at the church. I gasped. I knew it! Deacon James had been trying to get at my mom for the longest. He always found a reason to sit or stand near her in church and was always offering to do stuff for her. He wasn't bad looking either. Good catch, Mom. She chuckled, then took on a more serious tone. Trina, yes, I do have this date, but I want you to know I'm serious when I say that I'll cancel in a heartbeat for you. You're my baby. You come first. My eyes welled up with tears for many reasons. No, Mom, you go ahead. And there's another break in the chapter. Child, listen, here we go. Later on that night, Anton stopped by. I popped a couple bowls of popcorn and we sunk into our semi-regular routine of watching Family Feud. We surveyed 100 people and asked the question, what are some recreational activities that are traditionally done in hot weather? Steve Harvey, the show's host, asked the contestants. Both Anton and I tried to answer first. Swimming, I blurted out. Ice cream, Anton exclaimed. We stared intently at the screen. Mary, a contestant on the show, hit the buzzer first. Swimming! You're right, said Steve. I stuck my tongue out at Anton. Told you. Whatever. He play-sulked and slumped into the couch cushions and ate a few handfuls of popcorn. You know what I just noticed, he said. What? I pressed mute because it was a commercial break anyway. Why do we always end up watching this same show? And why are you always on the opposite team side? I shot him a cocky glance. The better question is, why are you always on the losing team side? I stuffed a handful of popcorn in my mouth. I do not always lose. Anton, yes, you do. Oh, my God. Yo, I wish Sydney and them were here. They would tell the truth. I rolled my eyes at the mention of Sydney's name. He looked at me. What happened between you and her? Nothing. I'll talk to you about it later. Right now, you need to finish getting spanked. Anytime, Anton said with a teasing smirk. Boy, stop. You know I didn't mean it like that. I grabbed the remote and unmuted the TV so we didn't miss the next round. The next question was a tough one. Public places where you're likely to catch the flu. Anton won that round, but I claimed that it was because my life's situations had me thrown off my square. Whatever, he remarked. What happened with Sydney? I sucked my teeth and told him what she did. Wow. Wow is right. How could you do something like that to someone you consider your best friend? I mean, I can kind of understand where she's coming from, but I understand you being hurt by it too. My ears grew hot. What you mean you understand where she's coming from? Trina, imagine yourself in her position. Your best friend is head over heels about this guy, but you find out a month before their wedding that he's cheating. What would you do? Tell her! Yeah, you would want to, but sometimes that does more harm than good. How so? Sometimes people don't want to see the signs and they end up turning it on you for trying to help them. I was not ignoring the signs. Look, I'm not trying to start an argument with you. I'm just trying to get you to see what Sydney could have been thinking. Well, I disagree with your thoughts and her position. You would. I threw a piece of popcorn at his head. Oh, it's like that? It was game on. Pretty soon, my entire living room was scattered with popcorn. Anton and I were beside ourselves with laughter. He certainly knew how to bring out the kid in me. You better help me clean this up, I said, wiping a tear from laughing so hard. It's your fault. He swept some popcorn off the couch onto the floor. Plus, you lost. Loser cleans up. It's the rules. What rules? The ones in my head. I rolled my eyes and nudged his shoulder. Weirdo. We were silent while we cleaned. I grabbed the vacuum and Anton went to work on the couch, table, and love seat. Good as new, I remarked, admiring our handiwork. Except your hair, he said, and took a step toward me. I faked a jaw drop. You got popcorn in my hair? Hey, it's all fair in love and war. I just stood there as he pulled stray popcorn from my hair. Hey, you know what my mom said earlier? He stared into my eyes. What? Just then his phone rang. Why is your ringtone so loud? I plopped down onto the love seat while he answered his phone. Hey, Ashley, he said. Who is Ashley? I frowned. I watched him as he laughed and made small talk with this Ashley person. When he hung up, he had some explaining to do. I dove right in. Who is Ashley? I demanded. He shot me a snarky reply. Business? Who is she? Why are you so concerned? Are you seeing her? He held up his hands in protest. Why do I feel like I'm being interrogated? Are you? Why are you so concerned? I don't know why, so I fumbled for a plausible excuse. I mean, we're friends, right? Why wouldn't you tell me if you were seeing somebody? She's just a friend from work. A friend that you're seeing? Trina, all these questions. Because I want to know. You sound like you're jealous or something. That stopped me in my tracks. I'm not jealous. You sure? Yeah, I'm just curious about this Ashley girl, this friend from work that you never mentioned before. Well, we're just friends, okay? Fine. I unmuted the TV so we could watch the next episode of Family Feud. They always showed back-to-back reruns on Wednesday nights. I tried my best not to be bothered, but I couldn't resist taking sidelong glances at Anton and wondering about Ashley. He didn't seem to notice. And there's another break in the chapter. I returned to work the next day and resolved to stick it out. I got there early again to hopefully avoid questions from coworkers, and luckily, even Tasha wasn't there yet when I entered the building. I said hi to Ralph. His response was amicable, but I could tell from his eyes that he knew what had happened. He gave me a small nod to show his understanding. For that, I was grateful. I made it to my seat and quickly opened my company laptop, set up my iPad so I could listen to Ravi Zacharias talks on YouTube, and put my headphones on. I just wanted to be left alone today. Pretty soon, my coworkers began to saunter in, exchanging small talk with each other before dispersing to their desks. The company's setup was an open floor plan. The firm believed that open spaces lead to happy faces, so they chose not to give us cubicles. Instead, our desks were spread out in such a fashion that it was kind of like walking through a maze. A few desks here, a few there, and they were turned in every direction. They wanted to foster a familial atmosphere, so we had a full kitchen in our break room and a TV and couches in the employee lounge. We even had a game room, fully equipped with a pool table, video games, and the like. It was a great company, which was part of the reason I had kept this job for 4 years. I started as an intern and was hired full-time straight out of college. I could feel some of my coworkers' eyes on me as I pretended to focus on the data I was entering for a study on single parents. I felt a hand on my shoulder and looked up. One of my favorite coworkers, Jeff, nodded at me. I pulled one of my headphones off of my ear. Hey, he shot me a half smile. Hey, I shot him one in return. Let me know if you need anything. I swallowed. Thanks, Jeff. He nodded again and went to his seat. Like, what the fuck is he gonna do? Go sit down. Do your fucking job. Anyway, I was readjusting my headphones when I caught Tasha's eye. How are you feeling? She mouthed. I'll be okay, I mouthed back. She opened her arms in an air hug and I returned the favor. When I focused on my laptop, I noticed that Lacey, our supervisor, had sent me an email. And the email reads, Trina, I can only imagine what you're going through. Tasha informed me, and I let everyone know. I hope that was okay. I just wanted to make sure that everyone was sensitive to your situation. I was thinking you wouldn't want to be bombarded with questions. Hugs, Lacey. Her message made me smile. Lacey was something like a mom, even when I was an intern. I sent her a quick reply, assuring her that it was fine. She responded within seconds. P.S. If you need to talk, my door is open, despite the fact that it's currently closed. Smile. I did smile at her light humor and glanced up at her office. Her door was closed, but she waved at me through her glass window. She was on a call. I waved back, then returned my focus to the data I was entering. And here's a break in the chapter. The rest of the day actually wasn't that bad. I turned my phone on and saw a text from Malia asking how things were going. There was one from Sydney also, but I don't know what she said because I deleted it as soon as I saw her name. Charmaine texted me with the playful command that we were doing a spa day that weekend and I was expected to join them. No buts, no excuses, no choice but to come along and have fun. That made me smile. I responded to Malia to assure her that I was okay and to Charmaine to tell her I was down. I'd neglected them long enough and I certainly was not trying to deal with another intervention from them no matter how good their intentions were. That Saturday, we went out to eat first and after a long, languid brunch, we headed to the spa. That massage and facial were everything. Charmaine knew just what I needed. Thankfully, Sydney wasn't there. Anton didn't know what he was talking about. I argued in my thoughts to no one in particular. She should have never withheld that kind of information from me. Girl, I knew the spa would do the trick. You are glowing, honey, Charmaine said and took another sip of her mimosa. We decided to hang at her house after the spa. I took a sip of mine and enjoyed the taste. Charmaine really knew how to make a good mimosa. You're so right. Thank you for inviting me. I looked at Malia to let her know that she was included in my show of appreciation. She smiled in return. Malia was so sweet. It was Sydney that was the backstabber. My eyes darkened at that thought. What? Charmaine asked, noting my expression. Is your drink too strong? No, it's perfect. I'm just glad Sydney's not here. Charmaine opened her mouth to say something, paused, then set her drink down. Actually what? I shot back. You know something, don't you? Tell me. Calm down. She's not coming, but we do want to talk to you about her. Charmaine, I'm not trying to think about that girl today, and I don't feel like having a talk. I huffed a loud sigh. Well, you brought her up. We're all best friends, Trina, Malia chimed in. We are, I gestured to include the three of us, but she's no longer part of my circle. Come on, Trina, that's not fair, said Charmaine. I don't even see why this needs a conversation. Neither one of y'all can sit here and tell me that you would do so easily. No, that you would so easily forgive something like that. I looked at them to gauge their reaction. Nothing. Okay, well, it may be you, Malia, because you're so soft, but definitely not you, Charmaine. I crossed my arms over my chest for emphasis. Charmaine looked taken aback. What's that supposed to mean? I don't hold grudges. Not saying that. I'm saying that you and I have similar personalities. Have you noticed how Sydney didn't let you in on her little secret? Or did she? She paused. No, she didn't. But still, she was probably scared. Trina, you were completely taken by Brandon. I have a feeling that if she did tell you, you would have brushed it off. No, I wouldn't have. Remember Rebecca? She cocked her head to the side. It was my turn to pause. Charmaine and Sydney had both tried to convince me to leave Brandon when I told them about Rebecca, but I didn't listen to them. Whatever. I took a sip of my drink. I just hate to see you guys fighting like this, said Malia. Sydney's really sorry, Trina. She feels horrible. Don't try to take up for her. And you don't try to deny the fact that you wouldn't have listened. I love that Charmaine was a straight shooter, but she needed to let up. I said whatever, Charmaine. I sighed and she sighed and rolled her eyes. She looked at Malia. Welp, we tried. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Oh my God. Y'all, I need to I need to know what's going to happen. Hey, Nora, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Hey, Tracy J, welcome, welcome, darling. I appreciate you being here as well. All right, I hope I ain't missed nobody else. I think I got Jan. Yeah, she was further up top. All right. Lord. All right, so what are y'all thinking? Well, it's a short, so it don't matter, child. We in this. We done already stuck the tip in and star stroking, child. It's too late now. It's too late now to be talking about. No, I don't think I really I want us to do this. Oh my God. Listen, just had to be me. Depression. I thought I was okay after that first day back to work, but I wasn't. Pretty soon, I found myself using up my personal time by calling out at least once a week. Things only got worse when I went to my first court date. The judge was set to make his final decision at the next hearing as to whether I'd be convicted of a felony or put on probation and have to pay a fine, along with reimbursing Brandon for his car repairs. The only thing that whole situation did was dredge up the memories of that night, the sight of his and hers license plates, the way he protected her, and how he basically told me that I was something that just sort of happened. I began to lose my appetite. My error rate at work steadily increased. I was put on a temporary removal of my headphones, the company's policy to help us focus so we could get back on track. After my fifth call out in 4 weeks, Lacey called me into her office. Lacey, I'm so sorry for how I've been doing. I started, but she held up her hand to stop me. Trina, please sit down. I wasn't sure how to take her tone, so I did as she said. I sat down. She sighed. I wanted to have a quick word with you before I sent you to human resources. My jaw dropped. HR, you're firing me? My mind was swimming. No, you're not fired. I set up a meeting for you with Regina. She's in charge of our employee assistance program. You've been working here for 4 years, so you qualify for those benefits. What is that again? Well, Regina can explain it better, but basically the EAP is a benefit that the company offers that'll help you with personal issues that start to take a toll on your work. You're a valued employee, and we want to see you succeed. My ears reddened. I could barely look into her eyes. Trina, I know you're going through it. That's why I contacted Regina. Please take advantage of all the benefits we have to offer. I used the program during a difficult period in my life. I looked up. You did? She nodded. When I got divorced, I started to spiral. This was before you started working here, but I took advantage of the EAP, ironically through Regina, and they gave me time off work along with counseling to help me get on track. It didn't solve all of my problems, of course, but it felt so good to know that my job had my back. You know what I mean? I nodded. Go ahead to HR now. Regina's waiting for you. Make sure you take your things because they might send you home for the rest of the day. My eyes blurred. Thank you. I blinked back tears. No problem. I'll see you when you come back. Hopefully much happier and much healthier. That caused me to genuinely smile. I grabbed my things from my desk, ignored the questioning stares from my coworkers, and made my way down the long hallway toward human resources. It felt eerily like being sent to the principal's office, but in a good way, I guess. When I got there, I immediately felt welcome. Regina was an older woman, probably about my grandmother's age. She smiled and asked if I wanted a coffee or tea before we began our meeting. I politely declined, and she went into her explanation of the employee assistance program. Essentially, I could get up to 12 weeks of unpaid leave from work with a clinical diagnosis. And the company also offered the option of seeing a counselor twice a week, all part of the company's program. I was taken aback by this information, but I knew I would accept her offer because it was exactly what I needed. And there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. I still had some personal time, so I submitted a letter to the Human Resources Office to request a week off before I started the counseling sessions. Now, I could have taken advantage of the offer of up to 12 weeks off, but I didn't want to go through the trouble of getting a clinical diagnosis. My mom, Malia, and Charmaine, and even Anton urged me to just go ahead and do it, but I felt that was too embarrassing. Everyone already notices that I've been messing up at work. I'm not about to have a label attached to me on top of that. Girl, getting a diagnosis for a valid reason is nothing to be ashamed about, my mom had said. I know, Mom, but I would rather just do the counseling. I could tell she wanted to fight me on it, but she let up. Okay, Trina. Her eyes welled with tears. I just don't like how what Brandon did is affecting you. I think part of me didn't want to believe I was depressed, though I was. The first few days of time off from work felt great. I took a few hours each day to relax and binge watch some of my favorite shows to catch up. By the fifth day, the pain of my breakup with Brandon started to set in. I found myself Facebook and Instagram stalking Brandon and India. Bad idea. I almost lost it when I saw her baby bump. Apparently, the twins were coming along just fine. What did he see in her that he didn't see in me? I asked myself this question over and over until my brain hurt. I couldn't for the life of me understand how Brandon could engage in a 3-year relationship with me while being in a relationship with India, plan a wedding with both of us, leave me on our supposed wedding day, and move on like nothing had happened. And now he was living his best life with India, who was pregnant with his children. How did neither of them see a problem with this? I was obsessed with their social media pages. I couldn't stop looking at their pictures, posts, and videos. I guess a part of me was looking for evidence of a crack in their relationship. They were carrying on like everything was okay, but was it really? I was embarrassed at the thought of meeting with a counselor, but when I got used to the idea, I low-key looked forward to it. My phone rang, jolting me out of my thoughts. Hello? Trina, I just want to say I'm sorry. I rolled my eyes. So you called me from a block number? I needed to talk to you. Sydney, I told you we have nothing to discuss. No true friend would hold back that kind of information. I'm sorry, okay? I blinked and jerked my head back. I know you don't think you're about to get an attitude with me. I made a mistake. I was trying to do the right thing, but I didn't know how to handle the situation. Clearly, I snorted. Can we just talk this out? Can I come over? No. Come on, Trina. After everything we've been through, I don't want to lose you. Well, you shouldn't have done what you did. Click. I felt bad for hanging up on her like that, but she should have known not to call me block like that would magically solve our problems. And there's a break in the chapter. I say fuck her because no God. Anyway, the first day of counseling went okay. I basically just explained my issues. My therapist seems cool. He mainly just listened to me. I had my hearing about the case with Brandon and India. The judge agreed not to put it on my record as a felony. I have to pay a fine to the courts and fix Brandon's car. There goes my savings, at least some of it anyway. I guess I should have felt relieved after having the weight of a potential felony conviction lifted off of my shoulders, but instead I felt numb, like it was really over. I had no more ties to Brandon or India. Once this money was paid, everything would go back to business as usual. Where's the fairness in that? I know I did what I did, but why is it that Brandon gets to live it up with his wife and kids while I'm stuck here miserable with no one? As if life was responding to my questions, I heard a knock on my front door. I grumbled incoherently as I shuffled over to answer it. It was Anton. Hey. He assessed me with his eyes before I let him in. What happened? What did the judge say? I grabbed the paper from an end table and showed him my copy of the documents I signed. His brow creased as he read it, but then he looked relieved. You need help paying this? He laid the paper on the end table and crossed his arms. No, I got it. You sure? Yep. Where you coming from? He looked a little fatigued. I just hit the gym. Oh, how was your workout? We made our way to my kitchen and sat down at the table. It was okay. I focused on legs today. You never told me what happened at the counselor's office. It went well. Are you hungry? I have some leftover chicken Alfredo. His eyes lit up. Heck yeah. Girl, don't tell me you've been holding out. That caused me to smile, something I hadn't genuinely done in a few weeks. I got up and fixed us both a plate, microwaving his first, then setting him up with utensils and a drink before grabbing my own and sitting down to eat. Anton said grace, and we dug in. After a few moments of forks clanking against plates, Anton spoke up. Trina, I want to tell you that I really hope this counseling helps you. I don't like seeing you hurt like this. My heart panged. What do you mean? I mean, I know you mentioned that you were having issues on your job, but everything else about you is also showing that you're hurting. You don't smile like you used to. You don't really want to hang out a lot of times. Even your statuses on social media show that you are in pain. I just want to see you happy again. Anton's words touched me in a way that I couldn't even describe, but it wasn't just his words. It was his tone, his facial expression, his eyes, his everything. I'm so grateful to have someone like him in my life. There's a break in the chapter. The next day, I decided to heed Anton's words and accept Charmaine's invitation to lunch and to hang out at Malia's house. We were having a great time until Sydney showed up. What are you doing here? I immediately felt anger rise within me. She put up her hand to stop me. I don't want to fight, Trina. I love you and I consider you one of my best friends, even though we're going through something right now. I scowled at her and said nothing. Charmaine chimed in. Look, I, for one, am not trying to go in circles with this. I shot her a look. I'm not trying to be insensitive, she continued, staring straight at me. But life's too short for all this back and forth. You two need to have a conversation like adults, and you need to do it now. Malia nodded in agreement. I had close to zero appreciation for the attitude in Charmaine's voice or her choice of words, but in my heart of hearts, I knew she was right. Holding on to bitterness and refusing to forgive was not good. So you really want to do this? I cocked my head at Sydney. She nodded. Put your drink down first, though, said Malia, looking at my strawberry daiquiri. Chill, Malia. I'm not going to throw it at her. Charmaine chuckled. Right, you better not, because if you get any of it on me, we scrapping. I rolled my eyes and felt myself lighten up. Okay, Sydney, what's on your mind? I put my drink down, crossed my legs, and folded my hands across my knee in a mock therapist pose. Sydney sighed. Please, can you hear me out without judgment? Go ahead, was my crisp reply. She launched into this long explanation that sounded more like an essay than a plea for acceptance. I didn't really listen to much of what she was saying, but my heart was touched by her demeanor. I could tell by her body language and her gestures that she truly felt remorse for what she did, and that if she were given the opportunity to do it over, she would have made a different choice. When she was finished with her speech, she stared at me, her eyes pleading for my understanding. I attempted to remove as much sarcasm from my reply as I could. Apology accepted. Charmaine jumped right in. That's it? That's all you gonna say after all that? I cocked my head to the side. What else do you want me to say? She rolled her eyes. Whatever, Trina. Well, I'm glad you guys are gonna move past this, said Malia. Yep. I took another sip, but my heart panged with conviction at the way I was handling the situation, so I decided to stop being a jerk. I turned to Sydney. I really do appreciate your apology, Sydney. It'll probably take some time, but I believe this situation will work itself out. Now it was Sydney's turn to look relieved. Can I have a hug? I wasn't quite ready for that, but the girl was already standing up with tears in her eyes, so I reluctantly obliged. So, now that that's over, turn up! Charmaine raised her glass, and we all followed suit. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, I don't know how I feel about that, y'all. Hey, lovely Mitchell. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Listen, I know exactly how I feel about it. Yeah, fuck around and find out. I don't play them kind of friendship games. You don't get but one time to, nope. No, I don't believe in harming my fucking self. You got me fucked up. Try that shit on a bitch that failed kindergarten. Hell, no, ma'am. I don't know how to do that. I need to wet my whistle, y'all. I don't know. I'm not telling nobody how to govern themselves in their friendship. I'm just telling you what I would do, and that would be a huge fucking fuck no for me. Because the way I look at that, you could have told me a month ago, a month before my wedding. And then all of this shit could have gone down, you know, differently. I wouldn't have been embarrassed and spending out extra money and all of that shit, right? Because like, girl, no, you're supposed to be one of my best friends, and you let me walk into basically heartbreak. You're supposed to say something. Mm-mm. I promise you. Nah, it ain't a friend alive of mine that could tell you that I, Saki Mae Jenkins, would let them do some shit like that. Wait, who started calling me that? Saki Mae Jenkins. Child, I can't even remember who it was, but I don't even think that person come over here no more. But whatever, child. Anyway, yeah, no, I'm not going to let my best friend go out like that. Over it. Acceptance. It's been 3 months since I started counseling twice a week. I had no idea how much it would help me. It's not even like the guy told me what to do or anything. Just letting it all out seemed to be what I needed. Well, he did give me little activities to do, like journaling and learning my triggers and other things. But still, counseling turned out to be way better than I ever thought it would. Child, listen, that's what most people find out once they get past the fear of, you know, making the appointment and then actually fucking going. So anyway, there was so much uncovered in each session, stuff I didn't even know was there. Like Lacey said, all my problems aren't solved, but I feel like I've made a big step in the right direction. I feel like a new woman. I deactivated my social media account sometime after the first session with Raymond. I didn't need any distractions. You know how they say that you don't know who your friends are until you hit rock bottom. Well, whoever came up with that statement was right. I got some true riders in Charmaine, Malia, Sydney, Anton, and Mom. Oh, Mom's been quite busy with a certain deacon. Girl, your mama is popping, Charmaine chuckled. Stella done got her groove back. We were having a ladies' night at her house, and I just finished telling them about Mom and Deacon James and how they'd been on a cruise together. It felt so good to be back to normal with my girls. Don't I know it? I scooped up a heaping spoonful of mint chocolate chip ice cream from my hot fudge sundae. This fudge is heavenly. My eyes rolled back in appreciation. Do I got it or what? Charmaine patted herself on the back. She had made our sundaes. You got skills, girl, Sydney replied, enjoying her own creamy vanilla sundae. But why did you choose the most boring flavor ever, though? I wrinkled my nose at Sydney's ice cream. My choice was not boring. I like vanilla, Malia chimed in. I threw a pillow at her. Boo, you are such an angel. Malia ain't no angel. She got some twerk in her, Charmaine said, licking her spoon. Twerk in her? Sydney's face scrunched. What does that even mean? Ugh, Charmaine gasped in fake annoyance. Must I explain everything? She looked in the direction of her stereo. Alexa, play City Girls. Before we knew it, we were engaged in an all-out twerk fest. Yeah, we were back to normal, all right. And there's a break in the chapter. Since my therapy sessions were over, I had to say goodbye to Raymond, my counselor. You helped me through so much, I proclaimed, tears in my eyes. That's what I'm here for, Raymond smiled. After the session, I made my way over to Mom's house. I hadn't seen her in weeks since she was spending so much time with Deacon James. I used my key to get in and took my shoes off before walking down the hallway to her kitchen. I noticed that a few new pictures had found their way on the wall. I took in the shots of Mom and Deacon James smiling on their cruise. A tear formed in the corner of my eye, but I wiped it away and continued to the kitchen. I wasn't quite prepared for what I saw next. Mom and Deacon James were in a passionate embrace. He had his arms around her waist and his hands were squeezing her behind. I couldn't help it. I gasped and they broke their kiss and whipped their heads in my direction. I think we were all equally embarrassed. Girl, did you knock? Mom stepped out of the embrace, wiping her mouth and fanning her face with her hand. Deacon James just stood there looking uncomfortable, his hands in his pockets. I'm sorry, I didn't know you had company. I tried to look anywhere but at them. I cooked, Mom announced, as if that was the best news ever. I made some jerk chicken and white rice with gravy. You want some? She gestured toward the pots. My mouth was watering at the heavenly aroma, but I felt too awkward by now. I don't want to interrupt you guys this evening. Oh, no, it's fine. Mom looked back and forth between me and Deacon James. Honey, do you mind? Deacon James finally spoke, his smooth baritone voice almost comical in the present situation. Oh, no. I would love to get to know you more, Miss Trina. I blushed. Well, okay. I sat down and Mom fixed each of our plates. When she finished, she sat next to Deacon James and we all held hands as he blessed the food. The dinner conversation actually wasn't as awkward as I expected. Deacon James was funny, and it was even more hilarious to observe the interactions between him and my mom. They had only been dating for a short while and already had all kinds of inside jokes and pet names for each other. It was certainly a sight to see. My heart panged at how tender and kind he was toward her and she toward him. So this is what real love looks like. I'd never felt that way with Brandon. I left my mom's house deep in thought. I was overjoyed that she was moving on with her life and had found love, but it made me feel even more alone. I wish I had something like that with a man. Another break in the chapter, child. Not Mama and Deacon done rock the boat, Buck. You just ain't gonna never act. Be a good boy. Good googly moogly. Oh, mannish tail. He like, ma'am, knock it off. You in here reading books about sucking dick and licking balls. You telling me to behave. The next day, I headed to work. Hey, Ralph. I gave him a cheery smile as I passed him talking to another security guard. The other guard looked young and nervous, probably training, I thought. Just then, I felt my phone buzz in my pocket. I quickly whipped it out and swiped the screen. It was Anton. Hope you have a good day at work. I smiled. Thanks. I'll tell you how it goes. I walked in and saw my desk and chair decorated with flowers, balloons, and positive words like strong and courageous on little stickers. I was overcome with emotion and had to fight back the tears. Here she is. Lacey walked in carrying a sheet cake with yellow and white whipped frosting. Blech. Anyway, she set it down on my desk, gave me a big smile, and hugged me. Happy birthday, she said. My coworkers gathered in a circle and gave me a big round of applause, then sang the happy birthday song with Tasha and Jeff singing obnoxiously loud, causing everyone to laugh. Their smiles and cheers really made me feel loved and appreciated. I wiped my eyes. Thank you, guys. I totally forgot it was my birthday, I said, and I hugged each of them. We enjoyed our cake while talking about various office happenings, and then it was time to start our day. After work, I was surprised yet again with a birthday dinner by Mom, Deacon James, my girls, and Anton. We had a great time. It's unbelievable how much having a strong support system can really change the game for you. Lacey is truly a godsend for referring me to HR to take advantage of those benefits. I really work for a great company. I am floored. Before I went to bed, I reflected on all of the changes that had taken place in my life over the past few months, and the tears began to fall when I realized how much I had grown. Gone was the girl who felt so insecure that she held on to a piece of a man just to say she was in a relationship. Gone was the girl who bottled up her true feelings just to get a ring. After my moment of empowerment, I was inspired to write a short status on my Facebook account. I had deactivated my page for a while, but now I was ready to re-engage. I started with one sentence, but I couldn't stop writing until I ran out of words. I went into detail about what happened to me that day, how it affected me, and how, after counseling, I felt like a new woman. I looked at the message, thinking at first that it was too long and too personal, but I shrugged and clicked post anyway. Maybe it'll help someone else. Another break in the chapter, child. The next morning when I woke up, my phone was dead. I plugged in the charger and turned it on, then went to take a shower and get ready for work. When I got out of the shower, I checked my notifications and my eyes widened in shock. My post had over 3,000 shares and 546 comments. I also had 15 unread messages in my inbox, a slew of friend requests, and some texts from my girls and Anton. Wow. I murmured as I read the comments, bracing myself for the worst. On the contrary, the overwhelming majority of the comments were from people who were sympathetic to my story. There were a few hecklers in the comments section, but I ignored them and went to my inbox. The first message was from a woman named Laura. I didn't know her from a hole in the wall, but she shared how she had gone through a similar experience. Trina, we don't know each other, but your story really touched my heart. I continued to read her message, and when I got to the end, I saw that she mentioned she lived in my area and was wondering if I could put together a support group for women who had been through relationship issues and were looking for healing. I paused. A support group? I wrinkled my nose, not because I thought it was a bad idea, but because I didn't think I was capable of doing such a thing. I closed Laura's message without responding, then went to the next message. By the time I got through all of the messages, I was floored. Three other women lived in my area and requested a support group as well. I looked up to the ceiling. Lord, I prayed, is this what you want from me? And there's another break in the chapter. Sydney, Malia, Charmaine, and I headed out to lunch at the end of the week. We had so much to catch up on. My post had gone viral, and my inbox was flooded each day with messages from women sharing their stories and mentioning that I should start a support group. I didn't know how to take it. So, Miss Celebrity, how you been doing? Charmaine leaned back in her seat and cocked her head in my direction. Girl, please, I am no celebrity. I took a sip of Pepsi. Ugh. Relishing the crisp taste. Everyone is commenting on your post. It was so inspiring. Malia looked so proud of me. I blushed. Y'all are crazy. Don't downplay yourself, Trina, said Sydney. You went through a lot. Well, thanks to you, bitch. Sorry. I brushed a strand of hair behind my ear. I keep getting messages in my inbox saying I should start a support group. There, I said it. Really? Charmaine's eyes widened. You should do it, Sydney said. Yeah, I can totally see that in you, said Malia. My jaw dropped. These were not the reactions I was expecting at all. So you guys really think I could do something like that? Girl, yes. You have literally been glowing since you got over Brandon, said Charmaine. I thought about it, but what would I even say though? You can just share your experiences and go from there, said Charmaine. We can help you organize it, Malia said. Really? I was floored yet again. Absolutely, Sydney said. I'm sorry, y'all. No. Sydney could jump off the edge of the fucking earth and I wouldn't give a fuck. Fuck her. Hey, Chef Sky, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. I feel like, you know, people, you know, come into your life, you know, and ingratiate themselves into your fucking existence. And then to pull a fuck bitch move like that, girl, fuck you. Fuck you. Fuck all your ancestors and they raggedy ass ancestors too. Did I speak to you, Renee Sanders, child? I don't know. Yeah, I think they welcomed you. Yeah, they did. They welcomed you. So welcome, child. In case I didn't, I think I did, but I don't know. Anyway, glad you're here, child. Have a good time. So I just feel like if you're my friend, like, don't do that to me and then think we're going to go back to shit being sweet. No, no. The tea about to be real unsweetened round off up in this bitch. Like, don't do that. You know, I just feel like, yeah, no, I'm not doing that. Mm-mm. Nah, I don't feel like that's a good idea to, I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. And if I am, I don't give a fuck. Because this is, you know, for me, you know, I feel like, you know, if I trust you enough to let you into my inner circle, like, girl, don't fuck that up because it's real cold on the outside of it. I don't have nothing to say to you. Call me Saran. I'm all wrapped out. Yeah, it's definitely a wrap. It just don't work like that for me. And I, you know, maybe that's wrong. Yeah. I don't know. Maybe it is wrong, but I don't care. You know, I have to protect my own peace and I encourage y'all to do whatever works best for y'all. But what I'm not going to do is keep a friend around and, you know, in my space. Right. And then I got to worry about, you know, what this motherfucker's up to. Girl, no, I don't do that. Anyway. I had no idea what the hell I was doing, but I went for it. I composed a group message on my messenger app with all the women in my area who had asked for a support group, informing them that it was in the works. With the help of my girls and even my mom, we secured a venue. Ironically, the same one where my wedding reception would have been held, and set a date. When the time came, I stood outside the venue with Charmaine, Sydney, and Malia waiting for our guests to arrive. I got a text from Anton. I know y'all on y'all girl power-ish, but knock 'em dead, Trina. I rolled my eyes and smiled. Anton was the best, no doubt about it. I put my phone back in my pocket and greeted the first few women to arrive. The night went by in a blur. I went from barely knowing what I was supposed to say to giving an entire speech and receiving a standing ovation, to having a woman actually come up to me and ask me to be the keynote speaker at her upcoming women's conference. Me? I stared at the woman, feeling completely out of my element. Yes, you. She offered an encouraging smile. "Your story is so touching. I believe it'll bring healing to other women." I took a step back. "Well, to be quite honest, this whole thing is catching me off guard. I literally just posted a status on Facebook and all this happened." I gestured around at all of the other women who stood in small groups of two or three, chatting and enjoying the atmosphere. "That's how God works," she remarked. "He takes our experiences and uses them to mold us, but also to help others. He works it out for our good." Long after that night was over, that woman's words stayed with me. I found myself praying again and again, "Lord, is this really what you want from me?" And that's the end of that chapter. Right, Jasmine, right. I'ma always think about what you did. It's gonna be hard for me to trust, you know, what you say. And I mean, I don't know about, you know, the rest of y'all, but you know, I tell my friends that I love them. You know, they know that I pray for them. I don't know. Y'all just got to take that to the lab, honey. And whatever you get out of it, that's between you and the Lord. I don't listen to me, honey, because, I'm not the one to give you that kind of advice, baby doll, because the way my give a fuck is set up, apparently you didn't give a fuck about me, so why in the fizzly fuck should I give a fuck about what the fuck you feel? Because I don't. No, sorry. It's not going to happen. All right. Trying something new. Hope. Since that night, I have had 6 speaking engagements. 6! The support group is also going strong. We have fluctuations in membership with different women joining and leaving, but we have a core group of 5 to 7 women who have been consistent, along with my girls, of course. "You know what? I think you should come up with a name for your group," said Charmaine. I stared at her. "I never even thought of that." "A name would be so cool," said Malia. "That would make it official." "Let's brainstorm," Sydney said. We were congregated at my house, relaxing over a long holiday weekend. We were set to hit the beach the next day. "Oh, you should also start a blog," said Malia. I wrinkled my nose. "A blog?" Charmaine chuckled. "Yes, Soulja Boy." She was referring to the rapper's infamous Breakfast Club interview, which had become the source of hundreds of memes. I rolled my eyes. "Whatever, Charmaine, but a blog, though?" "Well, you are a great writer," Sydney remarked. "I don't think I have that much to say, though. Girl, just let go and let God, honey." Charmaine raised her hands in the air. "You are so silly," I said, and we shared a laugh. "How about Know Your Worth?" said Malia. "Know Your Worth?" My eyebrows furrowed. "Yeah, because think about it. With all of your experiences with Brandon and everything, that was about finding yourself and realizing you had value. So, know your worth. Get it?" We all sat there, taking in her words. Charmaine spoke first. "Girl, you deep." She looked at Malia in awe. "Speaking like a modern-day Maya Angelou. Get this girl a mic." We all shared another laugh at Charmaine's silliness. "I really like that name, Malia." I nodded. "I think that's it." And then there's a break. My mom and I went out to lunch for what felt like the first time in ages. She was treating me to a meal at an upscale restaurant, Sinclair's, to celebrate everything that had been going on for the past year. "Trina, so tell me about your support group. How's it going?" Mom took a bite of her steak. "It's going great. More and more women are attending consistently, and it seems like it's really helping. The blog is also on fire. I'm thinking of writing a book." She stared at me in amazement. "You're writing a book?" I blushed. "I'm thinking about it." She dabbed her eyes with a napkin. "My baby." "Mom." I reached out and touched her arm, my eyes welling up too. "I knew you would get through it," she said. "I knew God would bring you through." "Amen." I took a bite of my own steak. "Whoa, this is perfect. It was so juicy and succulent, I wanted to gobble the whole thing up in one bite." That's what I tell him. "Yes, baby, this place is the best." Mom raised her glass in the air before taking a sip of her drink. "You're looking quite beautiful today," I said, marveling at my mom's new dress. Thank you, she cheesed. My baby bought it for me. My heart panged. Mom's love life was blossoming before my eyes, but here I was, still in a drought. Guess I should be grateful for everything else going on. So, I have something to tell you. It was Mom's turn to blush. What? I took another bite of my juicy, delicious steak. Mom pulled out a ring box and I almost choked. What? She opened it to reveal a diamond engagement ring. We're getting married. Her eyes glistened with happy tears. Oh my God, Mom, but wait. You kept the box? I chuckled. Mom was such a trip. Well, it was too big, so he's getting it resized. But I told him I wanted to hold it till he did so I could look at it. Isn't it cute? It's beautiful. I reached for the box to get a closer look at the sparkling diamond, but Mom snapped it shut and put it back in her purse. Gotta put this away before I get robbed. I burst out laughing. Mom, nobody's gonna rob you at Sinclair's. You never know. Honey, I came up the rough way. I know that's right, Mama. I shook my head. Mom was such a trip. Anton was another person I felt like I hadn't seen in literally forever. Between his hectic schedule working overtime as a corrections officer, probably the reason Mom liked him so much, and my job, support group, and speaking engagements, life was a whirlwind. We had been keeping up with each other through texts and phone calls, but whenever we tried to get together, one or both of us was busy. Not tonight. I was just getting settled in for what was going to be a peaceful and probably boring night when I heard a knock on my door. I opened it and my jaw dropped when I saw Anton standing there with a gigantic plastic bag full of popcorn. The bag had to have been at least 3 feet long. He was carrying it over his shoulder with one hand propping it up and holding a 3-liter bottle of Pepsi in his other hand. Boy, what are you doing here? And where in the world did you get that huge bag of popcorn? We're watching Family Feud tonight, and I'm winning. I hope you got your game up, girl. With that, he stepped around me and carried the popcorn and Pepsi to my living room. I don't know how you think we're getting through that whole bag. I grinned at him. My heart was full of joy. He plopped down on my couch, and I sat across from him on the love seat. Oh, I jumped up again. Cups! I ran to the kitchen. And bowls! Anton called after me. Right, I said to myself. Bowls, too. When I returned, Anton had already flipped the TV on and was using the remote to navigate the channel that Family Feud was on. Well, you certainly came equipped, I joked, still tripping over how huge that bag of popcorn was. I poured us both some Pepsi and he filled our bowls with popcorn. I had to make sure there were no distractions. Distractions from what? I wrinkled my nose. As I previously stated, you're losing tonight. Now, for the next 5 minutes until the show starts, I'm gonna need complete silence. I need to focus. He somehow managed to keep a straight face through his entire pseudo-serious speech. I cocked my head, pursed my lips, and stared at him. He stared back at me. I raised my eyebrows and cocked my head to the other side. He took a deep breath, but the corners of his mouth began to quiver. I fluttered my lashes, and it was over. He snorted with laughter, and I joined in. Why you always gotta throw me off my square? He joked. Why you always gotta challenge me? I threw a few pieces of popcorn in my mouth. You should know by now I'm undefeated. He sucked his teeth. Yeah, okay. We'll see how true that is by the end of the night. 3 episodes later, Anton changed the channel. Why you change it? I said, tickled at how mad he was at losing. I swear you be cheating. He wagged his finger at me. Champions don't need to cheat. Okay, Meek Mill. He rolled his eyes. Don't be a sore loser, I teased, throwing a piece of popcorn at his head. His eyes widened. You really want to do this again? He gestured toward the bag of popcorn, which wasn't even halfway empty. On second thought, 5-second rule, I hopped up and grabbed the pieces of popcorn that landed on the floor when I threw them at him. You are so cute, he remarked. I brushed a strand of hair behind my ear and blushed. I tossed the popcorn into my mouth and looked at him mischievously as I chewed, then swallowed. He scrunched up his face. Ew! Come on, my floor is clean, I joked. 5-second rules don't apply to popcorn. Sorry to break it to you. I dropped another piece to the floor. Come on, try it, I dared him. I'm not getting salmonella. I threw my head back in laughter. Boy, you are crazy. You can't get salmonella off of popcorn. Just then, his phone rang. Hello? He answered, and I could hear a female's voice on the phone. For some reason, I felt my whole body tense. Needing something to do, I quickly grabbed our bowls and cups and took them to the kitchen to put in the sink. When I returned to the living room, Anton was finishing his call. He hung up and I focused my eyes on the TV screen, pretending to watch Jeopardy. After a few moments, Anton must have picked up on my shift in attitude. What's wrong with you? Nothing. Who said something was wrong? Well, you got all silent. What's up? Nothing. I reached over and grabbed the remote from my coffee table and turned the volume up. I felt Anton's eyes on me. Trina. I put the TV on mute, no longer able to take it. So who was that? Ashley? As unbothered as I attempted to sound, I knew it was a fail. Anton paused. Oh, so this again. I shrugged my shoulders and reattempted to be unbothered. It's fine if you're seeing her. You can just say it. Why do you do that? Do what? I crossed my arms over my chest. Pretend you don't want me. His words hit me like a ton of bricks. Huh? What you mean? You pretend you don't want me, but when you think I'm talking to another woman, all hell breaks loose. It was suddenly very hot in that room. Did somebody turn the heat on? I broke out into a sweat. I don't understand where this is coming from. Well, I do. I couldn't meet his eyes anymore. The intensity was too much. I almost jumped out of my skin when he came over to the love seat and sat next to me. When are we going to stop playing this game, Trina? My heart skipped a few beats. What game? You talking about Family Feud? So lame, but it was the best I could do. He turned his body more so that he could face me directly. When our knees touched, I felt fire shoot all through me. I took in a deep breath. I'm not talking about Family Feud, Trina. I'm talking about us. Us? I am never telling anyone about this conversation. I was becoming more embarrassed, yet more turned on by the moment. Yes, us. Me and you. Why don't we try us? I finally met Anton's eyes and realization dawned. I had been looking for love all this time, and all this time, love was right in front of me. And that's it, y'all. Just a cute little skippity-pap. That's it. So what you think? I hope y'all liked it. But if you didn't, oh well, too late. I done already read it. And just like you can't unfuck somebody, I can't unread this damn book. So that's it for that one. Okay? I liked it. I'm mad that nothing else was said about how, y'all know I be needing to, know about the whole, you know, getting, she needs to get back at him, not get back at him, but you understand what I'm saying. What the fuck is it? She needs to get her money back. Like, he played on her fucking top. That's how I feel. Right? I mean, do y'all understand what I'm saying? I just feel like that is like some of the dumbest shit that he could have ever done. Hey, Kim Cash, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Child, did I speak to you already? I don't know. Anyway, so wait, what you say? I can't remember who I spoke to and who I didn't. So L Boogie said, I had a childhood friend that I told about her man, and took his side saying I was lying. So I cut that broad. Okay, so she took her man's side. Okay, yeah, that's what happens, child. I told y'all about the friend that did that shit to me. I was like, man, fuck that hoe. But yeah, anyway. Now, see, I don't play about my bestie and she doesn't play about me. Right, that part. Girl, you better say that again, said he said, child. But, oh my God. Have I got something for y'all? Seeing as how you just said that, hunty lamb. I wasn't planning on coming back again today, but I reckon I might have to come on back with a cute little skippity pap because, child, I got a couple your digs that'll fit that fucking scenario perfectly. Mm-hmm. Y'all listen, I just feel like now here y'all go with the bullshit. Hey, Nikki T. Girl, where your ass been? She said, hi, everyone, driving and listening after having to play some serious catch up. I miss y'all. We miss you too, girl. Lord have mercy. I don't know. I'm not trying to tell nobody what to do with their friendships or whatever, because that ain't really none of my goddamn business. But I'm sorry, y'all. At the end of the day, yeah, I don't play that kind of fuck knuckle bullshit. I really don't. That is some, yeah, that shit'll get you. Nah. Mm-mm. No, ma'am. Don't do that. And then to be like, I guess I feel like, how do you call yourself my friend? And you can hurt me like that. Like, don't do that. Don't do that. So much boo-boo. Don't do that. It's so many other things that you could have done that you didn't have to do that. Oh, it's pretty. Do y'all know that I just updated the You Dig, and now I realize that you could have all of these little... So I just saw the one from L Boogie the other day when she was like, I was like, it says personalized note, but I can't see it. Well, now I get to see it. So now I see the one from La. Oh, that's cute. But I can't tell what this says. Girl, listen, I'm sitting up here. Oh, it's mwah, like a kiss, right? Oh, that's cute. Okay. I'm still going. Hold on. Okay. Child, listen, I'm all fucked out the game with this.
Here comes the money.
Here we go. Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money.
I like it. Thank you for the tip, Kim Cash. And she said, for always giving us a good kiki. Yes, indeed. I didn't even know that, y'all. I don't be updating shit on my phone. So when that stuff starts showing up, talk about personalized note, I was like, why the fuck would they type personalized note? Oh, now I see the one from Shakara here the other week said, thank you for welcoming my mom with a warm welcome. And the picture behind it. Oh, that is too cute. Where all the little stuff? I like it. Y'all, it don't take much to make me happy. You know, unless we doing the horizontal mambo, then you got to put in work to make me. TMI, but I'm just saying, if you gonna be here, child, you gonna learn a few things, you heard me? And that's on some real shit. All right, let me shut the fuck up so we can get to this next book, hunty. Because I liked that one, but this one is little. But, oh, I gotta read... Kim's message. She said, yeah, that's why I don't get involved. You know, the friends who you can and cannot say nothing to them about their man. Yeah, right, y'all. Listen. Mm-mm. Nope, nope, nope. And then she said, I used to have a friend that believed everything her man said. So one time I seen him out and about with another chick, and child, his secret was safe for me. Not his secret was safe with me. Mm. But see, my thing is, in this day and age of social media, that's when you just snap a little picture and, you know, send a quick little skippity-pap from, you know, like a, make you a fucking, what do you call it? A fenster. And, you know, drop it in a, what, you know, you dig. So, but yeah. Oh, hey, Kay. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I think I spoke to you already, but I don't know if I did or not. You didn't say I didn't speak to you, so I'm assuming I did. What happened? I left for a second. Oh, girl, he left her at the altar. Yeah. Yep, he left her at the altar. Watching her get ready for a whole wedding, that's foul. Yeah, it is. It is. I ain't talked to my cousin for like 8 months because of an ugly nigga. Oh my God, Kaylin. Why you gotta be ugly though? Call me Kiki Palmer. I don't know that bad, okay? Oh my God. Oh my God, child. Listen, Kim, I was almost heading to jail when that happened to me. So I've learned to keep my mouth on hush, right? Child, listen. Well, it is a little pamphlet, child. But I would have told her about that wedding and reacted, right? Yeah. Because after that, you know, like, I'm not going to watch you get ready for a whole fucking wedding. Mm-mm. With the whole fucking wedding, no, God. Like, if you don't want to be my friend after I tell you that, that's cool. But I'm going to get it off of me. I'm going to get it off of me. Now, what happens after that, ma'am, that's on you. I don't have nothing to do with that. That's between you and that nigga, okay? That's your man, 100 grand. That's your man. You going to stick beside him? Okay, but at least you know. Now, don't come to me and tell me that he done fucked everybody that you know, including your cousins and shit. I don't want to hear nothing about that. You can't come to me about that nigga, period, because I done already told you. That's all. But yeah, she let her get fucking embarrassed on her wedding day. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Send it to her anonymous. Not as you. Get you a Finsta and drop it in that whole inbox. That's what you do. Mm-hmm. And just say, hey, girl. Oh, she made up with the girl. That's what happened, Kay. They made up. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they made up, child. No, God. I don't like that, but okay. So Kim said, child, I don't get involved in domestic disputes because your ass will not dead. Your ass will not dead and they all in love. Hell no. Oh, I think you meant be dead. But yeah, I don't. Nah. Mm-mm. Yeah, you can't. You got to mind your own fucking business. All right, so let me remind y'all of this next book so we can boogie on down the road, because child, it's 3:49. Shit. I was expecting for us to be getting ready to get the fuck out of here, but I was like, okay, these are short. Now I may not be able to come back to y'all with a cute little skippity-pap. All right. So the next one that we're reading, y'all, is In Love with My Uber Driver. So I have to write the timestamp for where the shit starts because it's two books in one thing. So, hold on. Now, for those of you, right, yeah, don't call me about Tyquavion or none of that other shit. Mm-mm. I don't want to hear about it. Not Tyquavion, though. And I was tripping when I saw somebody say something about somebody named Daquan the other day. Child, listen, for those of you that used to be over here when the Speakeasy child was first, Daquan, still alive and well, honey. All right. In Love with My Uber Driver. All right. So for those of you, again, like I said, that weren't here, I can read the little synopsis right quick. As soon as I get to it, child. All right. So the synopsis for this one is, Sylvia can't seem to get past her trifling ex, Jameer, or her traumatic vehicle accident that left her psychologically paralyzed. Dontrell is still stuck on his ex, Samaya. Or is it Samia? Who cares? Both seem to be nowhere near ready to try something new. But when Dontrell ends up being Sylvia's Uber driver, their lanes begin to shift in another direction. All right. So that was that one. Okay, so let's get this party started. And this one actually has numbers. So let me get this timestamp, child. Okay, got it. Chapter 1. Sylvia cut into the intersection, barely noticing the car swiftly approaching her entry point, totally unfazed by their honking. She just wanted to get home. I can't believe him, she exclaimed, wiping yet another tear from her eyes. She increased her speed. She was only 4 minutes from her apartment. Images of Jameer with his model beautiful date, Veronica, flashed through her mind, his hand covering hers, her adoring smile. The two of them snuggled close in a booth at Sylvia and Jameer's favorite restaurant, taking the perfect Insta-worthy selfie. I knew I shouldn't have gone there today, she wailed. The tears welled up again. She fought to push them back so she could see clearly enough to get to her apartment without ugly crying for the whole world to see, but they refused to be held at bay. She increased her speed even more. She was going 60 in a 35, but at this point she didn't care. She quickly swerved to turn left into her street, but not before she saw the huge truck barreling toward her from the opposite direction. In a matter of seconds, she saw a blinding light, then heard the sickening crunch of metal as the massive truck and her little hatchback smashed into each other. Her car spun, flipped twice, and landed on its wheels before it finally stopped. Multiple airbags smacked her face and chest, and thank God she was wearing a seatbelt so she wasn't thrown through her shattered windshield. She smelled smoke and felt a burning sensation on the left side of her face. She clawed at the handle and wrenched the door open with wild, desperate frenzy and stumbled out of her car. She made it two steps before collapsing to the ground. And there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. How in the hell? Already, this one's starting out. Why we got to get a wreck straight out the gate? Oh, my God. Mm-mm. Okay. 1 year later, Dontrell and Roland sat at their favorite spot, Checkers, a place where they could unwind, plan for the future, drink a few beers, and shoot pool. They'd been boys since day one and planned to open a barbershop together, but they had run into a few roadblocks when applying for a small business loan. Roland had a felony, and Dontrell had credit issues. Shit, that's one hell of a fucking roadblock, nigga. That's a goddamn mountain in the middle. Sorry. They didn't let that stop them from pursuing their dreams, however. Dontrell got financial aid to go to barber school, and Roland enrolled as well, but he had to pay his own way through various sources of income. His job doing janitorial work at a hospital and the payments he received from winning local rap battles and performances with his rap group, Crowd Pleasers. Dontrell worked at a pizza shop, and in addition to that, he drove for Uber. Yo, I can't wait till we get our shop, nigga, Roland said, and Dontrell could see the excitement in his eyes. Me either, bro. Dontrell took a sip of his Heineken. I can't wait to fully be my own boss. His manager at the pizza shop found new ways to piss him off almost every day. 1 second, y'all. It was a far cry from the freedom he experienced driving for Uber, but he couldn't make enough money doing Uber full-time, so he used it as a supplemental income to save for their barbershop. Shit, seemed like that's the wave nowadays. Roland took a long swig of his Guinness. A faraway look crossed his eyes, then his expression changed to a mischievous grin. Wait, nigga, so let me tell you about this bald-headed, Incredible Hulk-looking-ass bitch I had to deal with today. Dontrell chuckled. Roland used the craziest and most vulgar metaphors to describe the various encounters he experienced while working as a janitor, but Dontrell knew his heart was in the right place. He suspected that Roland used sarcastic humor to mask the discouragement he felt due to his felony, so when Roland was in the middle of his rants, Dontrell just let him roll with it. He listened as Roland told the story of how the woman slipped and fell on the floor he had just mopped, despite him warning her repeatedly that it was wet. And nigga, I told a bitch at least 3 times, don't walk that way. Hey, ma'am, don't walk that way. But she still wanted to walk on the spot I just finished mopping. And of course, she slipped and fell. Shit, that's what her stupid ass get. He shook his head and took another swig. So anyway, you pick up any baddies today? Dontrell shook his head. Nah, man, not really. There were a couple, but I wasn't really trying to holler. Psh, why not? They already know you got a whip. After that, ain't shit but space and opportunity. Throw on some slow jams, set the mood, add that chick in your back pocket by the end of the ride. I don't know, man. I'm just not in the mood for female drama right now. An image of his ex, Samaya, flashed across his mind. She had truly put him through the ringer. He had been as loving, faithful, and as loyal as he knew how to be, but she still found a way to make him feel like shit, and then she cheated. After he broke up with her, he gave up on the idea of relationships. You're still hurting over Samaya, aren't you? Man, you need to get over that bitch, said Roland. I can tell when you're thinking about her by the dark-ass look you get in your eye. I put my heart and soul into that girl, man. I know, but you'll find another one. Dontrell opened his mouth to explain to Roland that it wasn't that easy, but he decided against it. Roland was just trying to encourage him to get back out there. He knew he meant well, but Dontrell just wasn't ready. There's a break. Sylvia sat back on her therapist's couch and sighed. This was the only place she found solace from her busy work schedule and constant flashbacks of her accident and breakup with Jameer. But ironically, it was also the place where she felt the most stuck. She truly enjoyed talking to Yvonne because she always gave her room to spill out every emotion she felt, but it seemed like she just couldn't get past the trauma of the accident, even though it had been an entire year. So how are you feeling today? Yvonne began. Would you like some tea or coffee? Yes, please. Tea would be great. Sylvia watched as Yvonne prepared her tea just the way she liked it, black with 7 splendors. Well, girl, that's a lot, ain't it? Yvonne took such care with her, and that kind of made her feel bad that the therapy sessions didn't seem to be working. Yvonne handed her the tea and took a seat in an upholstered chair across from the couch. So, how are you? I've been okay, I guess. Have you tried sitting in your new car yet? Sylvia cringed at that question. She had been promising Yvonne for weeks now that she would try to just sit in the driver's seat of her new car to take the first step toward getting back on the road. But as of yet, she still hadn't been able to bring herself to do it. Every time she saw her car, she thought of the accident and how stupid she'd been for speeding that night. And then the accident brought her back to Jameer, and she felt like a complete idiot for actually trusting him to be faithful. She should have seen the signs from the beginning. She blinked back tears and took a sip of tea. Sylvia, Yvonne said, her voice gentle with empathy and concern. Sorry, I was in a daze there for a minute. Too many memories. What were you saying? Have you tried sitting in your car yet? No, I haven't. She braced herself for Yvonne to yell at her and ask her why she was taking so long to just sit in a damn car, but Yvonne did neither. She was so patient. Sometimes Sylvia wondered if that was a good or bad thing in terms of what she needed in a therapist. She often felt like she needed someone to just push her back out there, but she was too afraid to voice this and too afraid of the possible implications if it actually happened. What about the speed dating? That was another thing Yvonne had been urging her to try. Sylvia didn't want to do full-on exposure therapy, so Yvonne tried making slight suggestions to help her inch her way back into the worlds of dating and driving, but Sylvia felt like she just wasn't ready for either, not even after a whole year. It sucked because her new car had been sitting in its parking space since she got it after the accident, but she'd never driven it, much less sat inside it. She asked her best friend, Katina, to drive it around the block for her every few weeks just so it would get some use, and her friends always obliged her strange request without pushing her to drive her car herself. She had to find a way to get out of this rut. And that's the end of that chapter. So now we see. Hey, little mama, welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Did I see anybody else? Okay. Let me get the timestamp, child. This one is going to be real quick. Because it seemed like it's just rolling. It's not many chapters, so anyway. Yeah, y'all let it count on down to the ground. I hope I ain't miss nobody else. Hey, Angela Caldwell. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. I am doing quite well, thank you. And I pray the same for you, boo. That was so nice of you to ask. Thank you. Chapter 2. Sylvia and Katina were having a girls' night after a long week. They sipped on their virgin daiquiris as they discussed love, life, and work. Why is you taking in all them extra fucking calories? This is me talking. To fucking drink a virgin-ass daiquiri. Girl, put the fucking liquor in there so at least get fucked up while you get fat. Hell. Anyway. Oh, baby, let me tell you, Katina drawled. She set her drink down on the coffee table and turned to face Sylvia on the couch. She rolled her neck as she prepared to tell Sylvia another one of her crazy stories. So, Remember when I told you about LaMille, right? Sylvia bit her lip and squinted as she tried to remember. The one with the dreads? Yes. So, honey, tell me why I went out with him on Wednesday night. She rolled her eyes, indicating to Sylvia that things were about to get interesting. Sylvia took a sip of her drink, relishing the sweet taste as she listened to her friend. Told y'all, all that fucking sugar gonna be a big bloated ass fucking whale and still gonna be sober as a goddamn cockeyed judge. Anyway, so girl, he tells me that he's taking me somewhere real fancy. So I get dressed up, beat my face, and have myself ready to go for when he picks me up. So we get to the restaurant and I'm like, oh, cur, we about to eat. Because it is one of those upscale $100-a-plate type places. Tell me why the dinner was going good until it was time to pay. Girl, he hands the waiter his card, and 5 minutes later, she comes back saying it was declined. Sylvia's jaw dropped. It was declined? Yes, honey, but that's not even the worst part. This nigga had the audacity to not even look embarrassed or nothing. He just looked at me like I was supposed to pay. I looked at him like, what are you thinking? You invited me out, remember? Huh. Oh my gosh. So what happened next? Girl, I told him I had to go to the bathroom. Sylvia chuckled as she imagined how this story would end. What did you do then? Listen, honey, I ordered me an Uber, paid at the hostess desk for my portion of the meal, and bounced. You did not. Girl, yes, I did. Ain't no way in hell you about to invite me out, run up a huge bill like that, then expect me to pay. If you didn't have it like that, we could have went somewhere cheaper. Wow. Right. Sylvia admired Katina's boldness and her no-nonsense attitude. Katina had enough spunk for both of them, so Sylvia often lived vicariously through her. So what about you, girl? You meet any sexy guys lately? Nah, not yet. Sylvia's mood sobered considerably. Hell, she wasn't even fucking drunk. Fuck what you talking about? But whatever. She didn't want to get into talking about her dating life, which was non-existent anyway, because Katina was always threatening, well, encouraging her by saying that she would set her up on a blind date if she refused to get back out there. Girl, you must be curving niggas left and right. Katina picked up her drink. What did you think of this drink? I added a little twist. Can you tell? Katina was always trying to come up with new recipes for non-alcoholic drinks as part of her endeavor to one day open a non-alcoholic bar. Girl, bah. Anyway, she wanted to do it in memory of her cousin Lily, who was killed as she was driving home drunk one night. So you open a non-alcoholic bar because she died driving home drunk from a bar. That's when your friend need to tell you, bitch, that's the dumbest idea I ever heard in my fucking life. But okay, it's really good. No, I can't tell what the secret ingredient is. Katina smirked. Good, because I'm not telling. Girl, ain't nobody trying to steal your recipes. You can never be too careful these days, Katina joked. Sylvia rolled her eyes. So how you gonna keep your bar going after you retire? And do you plan to be the only bartender there? She could tell by the expression on her face that Katina hadn't thought of those aspects of her business yet. Girl, I don't even know. But what I do know is my recipes are going in a secret vault. I already came up with the 16-digit passcode. I won't, so ain't nobody getting in. Sylvia chuckled. Katina, you so crazy. I know, but you love me. You right about that. Wait, can you bring me to work Monday? I forgot to ask. Monday? Girl, I don't know. You sure you don't want to try to just get in your car and drive yourself? Sylvia immediately tensed. They had discussed this at least 1,000 times by now. She knew Katina was tired of bringing her back and forth to various places, which was why she often used Uber to try to pick up some of the slack. I'm just not ready. Katina placed her drink on the table. I understand that, but you know you've got to get back out there sooner or later, right? I'll get in the car with you your first couple of times driving. You know I will, girl. Sylvia couldn't meet her eyes. She felt like such a failure for not being able to do such a simple thing like drive herself to work, but she didn't know how to get herself unblocked from the situation she was in. Sylvia, Katina coaxed, if you don't want to bring me anymore, you can just say it. Sylvia spat. She knew the aggression in her tone was uncalled for, but she couldn't take all this pressure. It seemed like no one understood what she was going through. If it were that easy, she would have gotten in her car ages ago. If it were that simple, she would have been in another relationship by now. Sylvia glanced at Katina, and she could tell that her friend was trying to contain herself from getting an attitude to match the way Sylvia had just spoken to her. "I'm sorry," Sylvia said. "Girl, it's okay. I know it's hard for you, but I just don't like to see you suffer like this. This isn't you. I can't stand how that nigga just took all your joy away." Sylvia's heart panged at Katina's words because she knew they were true. Before what happened with Jameer, she was full of life, full of energy, and on the go all the time. But since the traumatic incidents of that day, she hadn't been herself. "I know. I'm sorry," she repeated, not sure what else to say. And there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. "I'm sorry. The way I feel like it, nah, hell nah." "Ma'am, you gonna learn how to drive that damn car, and you gonna let that nigga wreck your whole damn life." Dontrell was driving through one of the busier parts of the city trying to get a hit for a new ride. His goal was to get at least 10 rides a day while he drove for Uber. That way he could compensate for the gas money he had to spend and save enough for his half of the barbershop expenses. He and Roland were very close to their goal. They already had most of their equipment in storage. They had brought it piece by piece. They'd opened their business checking and savings accounts and were licensed with the state as an LLC. Currently, they were waiting for the approval for the building that they had their eyes on. They'd done their research and believed it would be the perfect location to set up shop. Dontrell was startled out of his thoughts when he got an alert for a ride that was 6 minutes away. He needed to get on a lift too, because most of these folks out here driving be saying they drive for both of them. They drive for Lyft and for Uber. So, I mean, it's all the rage on Twitter. How do people be talking about when it ain't nothing to do on Lyft, they switch over to Uber. But whatever. He quickly tapped the circle on his screen before the timer ran out. "Picking up Sylvia," he read, and he followed the navigation to her address. When he got there, as he waited for her to come outside the duplex, he admired the new car parked in the driveway. It was nice, and from the looks of it, it couldn't have been more than a year old, and it was his favorite color, black. He was admiring the shiny rims when she emerged from her apartment. He was slightly taken aback by her beauty. She was wearing an oversized sweater, leggings, and knee-high boots. Her hair was swept up in a side bun with a bang coming down on one side. She wore no makeup, yet in his perception, she had a regal look about her. She needed no makeup to enhance her natural beauty. He was intrigued. He noticed a sadness about her, though. He could see it in her walk and in her downcast eyes. "Hey," he said when she sat in the back seat and closed the door. "How are you today?" She looked up at him and her eyes widened for a millisecond before she went back to her original expression. She forced a small smile. "I'm fine. How are you?" "Pretty good. That's a nice car over there." He gestured toward the vehicle he had just been admiring. "Wouldn't mind having one like that someday. Hopefully soon." "Yeah," her face reddened. "It's mine, but I can't drive it." His jaw dropped. "That's yours?" She nodded. "What's wrong with it, if you don't mind me asking? I have a friend who owns an auto shop, and his prices are really good. He can fix anything." He began navigating toward her destination, which was 20 minutes away. "Oh." She tucked her bang behind her ear. "There's nothing wrong with the car. It's me that's the problem." "Oh, too many DUIs?" he chuckled. "No." Her tone was neutral. "I have PTSD. I was in a bad accident." "Oh," he said, feeling stupid for prying. "That must be tough." "Yeah. Damn, this must be what Roland is always getting on me about. Now, I've been out the game so long that I don't even know how to approach nobody no more." He glanced at Sylvia through his rear view, but shit, she ain't gotta be all stank. I was just trying to make conversation. Sylvia fought back the tears. It was the first time she had revealed to anyone other than Katina that she had been diagnosed with PTSD. "He probably thinks I'm an idiot. Look how he got all quiet after I told him." They drove in silence the rest of the way. When they finally arrived at her job, Sylvia couldn't wait to get out of the car. She quickly hopped out and accidentally slammed the door. She paused because she wanted to apologize and thank him for dropping her off, but before she could open her mouth, he was already driving off. She shook her head, frustrated with herself. "I really need to find a way to snap out of this." Child, listen. Dontrell and Roland were in a celebratory mood as they sat in their usual seats at Checkers. They had just finished a few games of pool, and now they were eating some wings and fries and sipping on a few drinks. "Shit took forever, but I'm glad we finally got approved," said Roland. they had closed the deal on the building and secured the proper insurance and licenses. Now, they were waiting for the renovations to begin. They were only able to afford the bare minimum, but it was enough to open up shop and get some business rolling in. They'd continue to renovate as their cash flow improved. Right, we one step closer, my boy. Dontrell took a sip of his drink, almost done with this pizza shit. Nigga, the air tastes better already, Roland breathed. You smell that shit? Dontrell burst out laughing. Bruh, something is seriously wrong with you. Roland's eyes widened like he suddenly remembered something exciting. Yo, I ain't tell you about this baddie I met a few weeks back. What happened? Dontrell sat up intrigued. Yo, you ever met a girl that just looked like she was really about something? Like she got it all together. The looks, the personality, everything? Dontrell was about to say no, but then for some strange reason, his mind went to Sylvia, the girl who was afraid to drive her beautiful new car. She had a regal look about her that had stayed in his mind. Yeah, I met one like that recently. Word? It was Roland's turn to look intrigued. You ain't tell me about that. How did y'all meet? First, tell me about your girl. Dontrell knew his story would be disappointing, so he let Roland tell his first. Turned out to be some bullshit. His expression darkened, and Dontrell almost felt bad for asking him to continue. We was kicking it, talking on the phone, texting, all that shit. I felt like things were about to get serious, so I told her I had a felony. Tell me why this bitch judged me. Damn. It was all Dontrell could say. Right. It's like her whole persona changed once I told her that. She basically told me I wasn't shit and she wasn't interested in me no more. She actually said that? In so many words, a nigga makes one mistake and he gotta spend the rest of his life trying to prove to society that he's not worthless. This conversation had gotten real deep, real quick. This was the first time Roland had ever really opened up about how he felt about his felony, and Dontrell wasn't sure how to take it. He decided it was best to avoid that topic altogether. I mean, the world is crazy, but look on the bright side, bro. We about to live our dream. We've been wanting our barbershop for years, and we about to open up soon. That chick may not understand you, but like you always tell me, you'll find someone who will. Dontrell was never really the mushy type, so he hoped his words were enough to help his friend. He couldn't tell, though, because Roland just shrugged his shoulders like he was done talking about that subject and changed the direction of the conversation. So, what happened with your chick? Shit, nothing. We ain't even get past the first conversation. Damn, why these chicks gotta be so complicated? Roland looked exasperated. Dontrell chuckled, though he found himself feeling the same way. Nigga, get out your feelings. Fuck these uppity-ass chicks. Let's just stick to our hustle. Speaking of, you know we got a show next week, right? Roland said, referring to his rap group, Crowd Pleasers. Oh, for real? Yeah, next Friday. You gonna be able to come through? You know it. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. He ain't even get a girl a chance to fucking say nothing before he just irked out on her like, God damn. Like, I don't think that that's fair, right? Like, who does that? I mean, he just dipped on her. She was trying to say something to him, and before she could even turn around, this nigga done got little already. He up the road and around the corner. Like, damn. But whatever. Anyway, child. All right. Did I miss you? Hey, sweet November. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Wait a minute. Lord Saki don't even be talking through these short books. Well, they too short to be, you know, chit-chatting and chopping it up and shit. Sorry. Y'all be over there in the backyard fucking around anyway, so it don't matter, child. Y'all be back there being the backyardigans. All right, I got my time stamp, so we're going to let that count down. Because, child, listen. I'm trying to get excited about the damn, you dig coming, child. So we could be all good. Hey, just be real. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. All right, here we go. Chapter 3. It was a packed house. Dontrell and Roland and the other two members of Roland's group, Rel and Steve, navigated through the tables to find an empty one. They took their seats and stared at all the people that had come out tonight. Steve could barely contain his excitement. This shit about to be rocking. You know they all here to see y'all, right? Dontrell said over the music. It was an open mic, but venues this size often book local artists and groups that had large followings to perform sets for pay to draw in a large crowd. Roland and his crew were basically local celebrities, and they fully lived up to their reputation. They won the crowd every time they performed because their beats and lyrics appealed to almost every audience. Shit, I can't wait to get up there, Roland said, and he glanced at Dontrell. Gotta let some shit loose. Dontrell knew what he was talking about. Roland had been having problems on his job. His supervisor had written him up after the woman who slipped and fell filed a complaint against him. Y'all about to rock this shit. I can feel it, Dontrell said, and he wasn't even gassing them. They truly had the talent, and people were always telling them they should try to get signed, but they weren't in it for that. They did it for the enjoyment and to make a few dollars as a side income. Dontrell's eyes scanned the room, and when he saw her face among the crowd, he did a double take. Sylvia was with another girl trying to find an empty table. They found one across the room from where Dontrell and the rest of the guys were sitting. "What's up?" said Roland, noticing his friend's intent gaze. "That's the girl I was telling you about." Dontrell nodded toward Sylvia and her friend. "The one in the red or the black?"
"The black."
"Shit. Good, because I was about to say the one in the red looks like what I need in my life," Roland smirked, and Dontrell chuckled. Dontrell and the guys enjoyed the first few acts while they waited for the crowd-pleaser set. They were going to close out the show. Although the acts were really good tonight and the DJ was truly putting in work between the performances, Dontrell couldn't resist sneaking glances in Sylvia's direction and wondering if she'd seen him. Roland picked up on it, so he decided to stir the pot. "Why don't you just go talk to her?" Dontrell tried to shrug it off, like it was no big deal, but said, "Nah, man, she's with her friend." "So? We about to get on stage in a few anyway. You gonna be sitting here all by yourself. You really want to look like some lonely dude who can't get a girl?" Dontrell contemplated his words. "You got a point." When it was time for the crowd pleasers to hit the stage, Roland gave Dontrell one more nudge, but Dontrell was hesitant. What if she blew him off? What if she and her friend had attitudes? As the group made their way to the stage amidst the anticipation of the thunderous crowd, Dontrell realized he had to make his decision. It was now or never. This was his moment. He literally was at a table all by himself, and he didn't want to look stupid. He took a deep breath, stood up, and made his way over to Sylvia and her friend's table. "She probably ain't even gonna remember me." When he approached, they looked up at him, and Sylvia's eyes widened in surprise. "Hello, ladies. Mind if I sit with you?" "Sure," said Katina, not missing a beat. She flashed a welcoming smile and gestured toward an empty seat as she looked back and forth between him and Sylvia. She quickly assessed that the two must have known each other from somewhere, based on the fact that she'd seen him checking out Sylvia since they walked in, and also from the way Sylvia's ears reddened when he asked to sit with them. "This could be interesting," Katina mused, happy that she could get a closer look at the mysterious stranger that seemed so captivated by her friend. "I'm Katina." She extended her hand to shake Dontrell's. "Dontrell," he returned the gesture. "Hey, Sylvia." "Hey." Sylvia glanced up at him just long enough to make eye contact, then focused intently on her drink again. Katina missed nothing. What was that all about? She had to find out more about this Dontrell. "So, are you enjoying the show?" she said, turning her attention to him. "Yeah, I came here with my boys. They about to perform." Katina's jaw dropped. "You're friends with the crowd pleasers?" She had heard a lot about the group, but had never seen them perform. Then she made the connection that Dontrell had been sitting with them before they went on stage. Dontrell nodded. "You see the one in the red jersey? That's my best friend, Roland." Katina looked at Roland front and center on stage, her eyes going all the way up, then down his body, then up again. She nodded her head with more than one gesture of approval. Roland was just her type. Tall, dark, dreaded, and sexy. Yes, bitch, we're definitely gonna have to explore that later. As they kicked their performance up a notch, the room darkened and the lighting shifted with various colors. The music thundered with palpable bass notes that went silent to build anticipation. Ah!
Oh my God, in heaven.
Ugh.
thought that shit was a spider on me. Oh my God. Woo, shit. I had to laugh at myself. Oh my God.
Oh my God. Listen. Apparently. Y'all forgive me. For those of you that are new here, I have PTSD. And it's technically arachnophobia, but I got I was bitten last year by a spider on a fucking live stream. And I'm always seeing something, right? So listen, y'all, I got my I got my hair in all of these pigtails over my head, right? And because my hair won't stay braided, I put a little black rubber bands on the ends, right? To keep them, keep the braid together. So anyway, apparently, you know how those little, they're cheap little rubber bands, right? So sometimes they break or whatever. Oh my God. So apparently the fucking rubber band popped at some point, but a little piece of it was still hanging off. So as I'm moving my head over here reading and shit, the little piece that was hanging actually fell off my hair and landed on my shoulder. And when I looked over, child, it was hanging, but it was rolled up. Oh my God. Oh, Lord, child, I thought it was a spider on me. Oh, dude, Jesus. Child, listen, I need a blunt and a drink right now. And y'all know I don't even fuck around. Lord have mercy. Jesus. Whew. Child, let me pick my butthole up off the floor and attach it back to my body. Oh, my God. All right, forgive me. Oh, Jesus. I heard myself after it had happened. Like, it had already happened, but it's 10 seconds from the microphone to my ear through YouTube. So I hear myself hollering after I heard myself hollering. Oh, my God. Help me, somebody. Child, listen. Just let me sip some fucking water. Oh, my God. I'm sorry, y'all. Lord, child, listen. Somebody, I got to give her the what you call it so she can send that. Because listen, child. No, God. Anyway, yeah. Sorry about that, y'all. I didn't mean to be, Okay. Now, where did I leave off at, child? Okay, there we go. I see where I left off at. Lord have mercy. Whew, yeah, I need a fucking Tokyo tea, and it's only goddamn Tuesday, okay? That's supposed to be a Friday or Saturday night thing, not a goddamn Tuesday afternoon thing, but here we go. The music thundered with palpable bass notes, then went silent to build anticipation. After that, the beat dropped, and Roland and his boys expertly cut into the song with their hook. By the middle of the first verse, people were up out of their seats, and many of the ladies were crowded around the stage. Dontrell sat amazed as Roland, Rel, and Steve worked the crowd. They brought the same energy to every show, and their fans loved it. Dontrell nodded his head to the beat as Roland's verse came up in their last song. Said I came up the rough way, used to make the guns spray. All around the room, Dontrell could see heads bobbing, hands in the air, and cell phones lit as people went live to record. His friend truly had a gift. Anyone who heard him could feel the realness in his lyrics. Roland may have made some mistakes in his life, but he was a fighter. The message of his song was to never give up on your dreams. After the song ended, their set was finished and the show was over. Dontrell saw a few ladies wiping tears from their eyes. Even though Dontrell had to have heard it 1,000 times, it still touched his heart every time too. "What did you think?" he said to Katina and Sylvia. Both of them looked awestruck. Wow, Sylvia said, finally speaking directly to him. That was amazing. Absolutely, said Katina. I've heard so much about them, but to finally see them live is crazy. Now I know what everyone was talking about. Her attention shifted as Roland, Rel, and Steve approached their table. All right, so here we go. Dontrell stood up to give each of them dap. Y'all killed that shit, yo. Thanks, man. Roland and Steve and Rel nodded in appreciation. For real, said Katina, looking directly at Roland. That was fire. Glad you enjoyed it. Roland returned her gaze with a smile meant just for her. So, do y'all ladies want to grab a bite to eat? Said Steve. Our girls came too. He gestured toward a table where two other females were waiting. Sure, said Katina. They settled on a restaurant a few blocks over. Once they got there and were seated, the conversations resumed. Sylvia and Katina immediately hit it off with Gia and Centrell, Rel and Steve's girlfriends, but Sylvia felt kind of overwhelmed by the whole situation. She knew from the glances Katina shot in her direction, the show, that she had some explaining to do about Dontrell, but she wasn't sure what kind of explanation she could give. Yeah, she was attracted to him, and he seemed nice, but she wasn't sure she was ready to try to pursue anyone new. She had to find a way to deter Katina from what she obviously already had in mind before things went too far. The idea of that conversation was stressing her, along with the fact that Dontrell kept trying to make conversation with her. She answered to be polite, but she wasn't sure of his true intentions. He could turn out to be just like Jameer, leading me to believe he's looking for something serious, but playing with my feelings all along. Then, as if her mind had predicted the future, in walked some model-looking chick, and Dontrell got all choked up. She shot Sylvia an assessing glare. Sorry, it's on two different pages. An assessing glare before she directed her attention to Dontrell. She didn't stay for long, but before she left, her words and actions clearly established that she and Dontrell had history, and they probably were still involved. And there's a break in the chapter. Sylvia and Katina got in Katina's car so Sylvia could be dropped off at home and Katina could get to her own apartment. Katina wasted no time. Listen, girl, I already know what you're thinking, and that bitch ain't even a threat. She turned the key in the ignition. Sylvia usually appreciated the fact that Katina always knew what she was feeling, but at the moment, she really didn't want to go there. Sure looked like it to me. She was clearly his ex. How could you be so sure? Well, for starters, she was trying way too hard. Secondly, she was clearly threatened by you. Did you see her eyes rake you up and down? Please. And lastly, he wasn't even bothered by her. He definitely choked up when she walked in the room. How would you feel if you suddenly saw Jameer after all this time? Sylvia didn't know what she hated more, the fact that Katina was so quick with her answers or the fact that they actually made sense. She sighed. Either way, I don't think I'm ready for all that. Sylvia, no, Katina, not tonight, please. Katina was silent for a few moments, and Sylvia knew that could only mean that she was trying to find a way to press the issue, but she eventually gave up. She sucked her teeth and fake glared in Sylvia's direction. Fine, have it your way. Dontrell could not believe his luck. He finally saw Samaya after all this time, and it just happened to be when he was entertaining the possibility of pursuing something new. When he saw her walk into the restaurant, he felt something when their eyes met. He wasn't sure if he still had feelings for her or if he was remembering what he thought they had. From the way she was acting, it seemed like she wanted to try to work things out again, but Dontrell wasn't sure if he could do that or go down that road again. He firmly believed that if a girl cheated once, she would cheat again, and he wasn't up for that shit. There was no way she was about to play him like a fucking lame. Nope, not for a second time. She probably heard about the fucking barbershop getting ready to open up, nasty bitch, and now she wanna come back, cheating ass whore. All right, his phone buzzed with a text from Roland. He swiped his screen to read it. Drop that bitch, face forward, my nigga. He knew exactly what Roland was saying. Forget about working things out with Samaya and try to see what was up with Sylvia. But he wasn't sure if he was ready for that either. At some points in their conversation, Sylvia seemed to be open to him, but at other times, she was distant. And then she completely shut down after Samaya showed up. In that moment, it dawned on him that Sylvia probably thought he and Samaya were together. He reached for his phone to text her, But then he remembered he didn't have her number. And besides, they weren't in a relationship anyway. So he owed her no explanation. He shook his head. I'm tripping. And that's the end of that chapter. She said, had to look up a Tokyo t-shirt. It's pretty. My favorite color. You so fucking silly. And I'm going to kick your ass, Kayla. So I'm going to get you a tarantula tee, auntie. Wow. And Buck, you too, huh? A tofu tee, huh? Wow. Okay. I see. All right. All of y'all can go to hell. I'm just going to keep on reading like I don't see this bullshit happening. That's all right. I'm putting cases on all of y'all jokesters. Gonna fuck around and be in the shoe program. Chapter 4. Silvio waited for an Uber after work. Katina was still at her job, so she wouldn't be able to give her a ride home. When the driver pulled up, she quickly got inside, exchanged pleasantries, and stared out the window on her way home. She was so engrossed in her thoughts that she barely noticed her phone ringing. She quickly swiped the screen to answer Katina's call. Hey, she breathed. Girl, we need to talk. Sylvia turned down the volume on her phone in case her driver was listening. She shifted in her seat to face the window. What about Dontrell? Katina! Sylvia could already feel a headache coming on. Listen, I know you've been trying to avoid this conversation, but I really think you should see what's up with him. What are you, on break or something? Yes, honey, and I have a full 30 minutes to devote to this conversation. Sylvia rolled her eyes. Can we just talk when you get out? Katina paused for a moment. Huh, I suppose, but I'm calling you the moment I leave here, and you better not pretend to be busy so you can avoid my call. Whatever, Katina. Whatever yourself, Sylvia. Love you. Love you too. Sylvia rolled her eyes and hung up the phone, but then almost immediately she felt conflicted. Katina was only trying to help. She was really the best friend a girl could ask for, always lending a listening ear, always giving her rides when she could, despite the fact that Sylvia had her own car. I really need to figure out how to get out of this hole. A few hours later, Sylvia was exiting another Uber to enter the counseling center. Today, Yvonne already had her tea prepared. This girl must be running up one hell of a goddamn Uber bill because what the entire hell? Like, aren't those things like super expensive if you're going a long distance or something? Like, it could cost a lot, right? This is crazy. Today, Yvonne already had her tea prepared. Okay, let's get down to business, Missy, she said after taking a sip of her own tea. Yvonne, do any of your other clients take as long as me to heal? Sylvia felt like this elephant had been parading around the room since the beginning of her therapy. Frustrated wasn't even the word to explain how she felt. Every person is an individual, and every individual is different. But what does that even mean? How long does it usually take? It varies. Some people, just a few months if they have a strong support system and a mild case of PTSD. Others can take years and even require medication, and some never get over it completely, but find various ways to navigate. Everyone truly is an individual. What if it takes years for me? She blinked back tears. She was tired of feeling deficient. Katina and Yvonne were always trying to reassure her that she wasn't, but it didn't lessen her perception of herself. There were so many days that she felt like she just wanted to hop in her car and drive around the block already, but every single time she got stuck. Every single time the flashbacks ensued. As soon as she saw the flashing lights from that truck, all bets were off. Sylvia, you faced two different types of trauma in the same day. That's a lot. I know you feel like you haven't made any progress, but you really have. You're working. You're maintaining your friendship with Katina. You're keeping up with your sessions here, and you're opening up more and more. I think you're closer than you think you are. Those last words gave her a sense of relief that she had never felt before. I'm actually close, but it doesn't feel that way at all. She wanted to say that, but she didn't want to ruin the moment. Thank you, she said instead. Don't thank me. You're the one who has been dedicated to this process. You've been trying really hard, and I don't believe it'll be in vain. A tear finally did escape, and Sylvia wiped it away. She accepted the tissue that Yvonne held out to her. Thank you, she repeated, and she finally felt something break inside of her. Maybe she really was almost ready. And then there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. That's what I was thinking, Kay. Don't she still got a goddamn car note? You paying a car note, goddamn car insurance, and paying for Uber. That's a lot when you add it up. Her phone rang again with a call from Katina almost as soon as she entered her apartment. She chuckled, "This girl." She swiped to answer, "Hey, beautiful." "Beautiful. Somebody's in a good mood. I just got home from therapy." Sylvia set her purse on the couch, kicked off her shoes, and sank into the cushions in the corner, tucking her feet under her. "Did she lock the door, though? That's what I need to know. I need to know. Oh, so is everything going good with Yvonne?" The two had never met, but Yvonne and Katina liked each other based on what they learned through conversations with Sylvia. "Yes, she's great. I felt really empowered after today's meeting. I think I'm almost ready." She braced herself for Katina's response. "Almost ready? Who are you? And what have you done with my friend, Sylvia?" Sylvia could practically see Katina smile through her phone. "I don't know. I just feel like it's almost time." "Girl, listen, I can't wait for the day. I'm so happy for you." And there's a break in the chapter, child, while they switch. "Hey, Akira, welcome. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you." So Ethic and Alani had me for weeks. Then y'all was talking about the Prada plan, and that had me in a chokehold. Then I realized I ain't read Moss to a Flame. Man, oh, child, listen, I didn't read the Prada plan, and not going to. I don't like that ya-ya bitch. I don't like her, the one that came to the house in the Ethic book, that ya-ya girl. I forgot what her real name is. I don't give a fuck. I don't like that hoe. Dontrell was at a gas station filling up his tank when he got an alert on his phone for a pickup that was 7 minutes away. His heart leapt when he saw that it said, "Picking up Sylvia." I wonder if it's her. He hoped so. He had thought about her almost every day since the open mic night. He decided he had enough gas for now and stopped pumping, replaced the nozzle, and quickly hopped in his car. He made his way to the destination, pulling up in front of what looked like a counseling center. "Process toward progress," he said, reading the name of the building. The exterior door opened and he saw Sylvia exit the building and head toward his car. "Hey," she said as she sat inside. "Hey, you just come from your counselor?" He hoped that didn't sound stupid. "Yeah, we meet once a week." "Oh, that's cool." He pulled away from the curb and headed down the street towards Sylvia's house. There was silence for a few moments, and Dontrell wanted to continue the conversation, but he wasn't sure how to proceed. "So, what do they do with you there? Like, how are they going to get you back on the road? Sorry, I didn't mean to sound rude. It's just that I've never been to counseling, so I don't know." He trailed off, having run out of words, and tensed as he glanced at her in the rearview. "I hope I'm not overstepping my bounds. She's had me try different things like journaling, talking about emotions and stuff, and now she's coaxing me to get in my car so I can start the process of driving again, but I'm not sure. And then there's this other thing." She stopped short, like she had said too much. "Do you want to talk about it?" She sighed. "It's just that the accident is not the only reason I'm seeing her." Her face reddened. He wanted to ask what the other reasons were, but he knew he'd be pushing it too far. He decided to change the subject. "So, you remember my friend Roland, right? From the show?" Her expression lightened. "Yeah, they were really good." He turned down a side street about 2 minutes from a house. "So, we're opening our barbershop very soon." "You're a barber?" Her eyes widened. Then she looked at his head. "Do you cut your own hair? Your waves are really sexy. I mean, nice." She reddened again. He chuckled. "Thanks. Yeah, I cut my own hair. We both went through school, but we had to save up our own funds to get our place. The time's almost here, and it's like a dream come true." "Wow, that is really great. Congratulations. You guys are so multi-talented." His heart warmed. "Thank you. So, what do you do for work?" "I'm a medical assistant." "Oh, wow, that's cool." "Yeah, but I always admire people who have that entrepreneurial spirit. My friend Katina's like that. She works as a preschool teacher and dance instructor, but she really wants to open a non-alcoholic bar." "A non-alcoholic bar?" Dontrell's face scrunched as he pulled down Sylvia Street. "I don't think I've ever heard of that." "I hadn't either before she told me about her idea, but I think it's a great concept." "Sounds interesting. So, do you mind if I..." he stopped talking and his heart dropped as he pulled up in front of Sylvia's house. There was a dude sitting on our steps with a backpack and a small suitcase. As soon as he saw them pull up, he stood to meet Sylvia. So this whole time she had a man. She looked like she didn't know what to say. I guess I'll see you later, Dontrell said, trying not to let his feelings show. She barely even seemed to notice him speaking to her as she got out of the car and made her way toward the guy. Dontrell couldn't wait for her to close the passenger door so he could get the hell out of there. Sylvia was completely in shock as she approached Jameer, who had stood up by the time she approached and had this look on his face like he had waited forever for her to come home. One second. Sorry, y'all. I didn't go out, did I? I'm trying to listen, catch up listening so I can know whether or not I'm trying to see. I guess I didn't blip out. Okay, I thought I had blipped out. Sorry. What are you doing here? She demanded. All of the feelings she experienced after their breakup rose within her. Sylvia, me and Veronica broke up. So you think you can just waltz back into my life like nothing happened? And why did you bring your shit to my house? I hope you don't think you're staying here. She resisted the urge to grab his suitcase and fling it into the middle of the street. Baby, listen, I can explain. Explain what, Jameer? How you were cheating on me for God knows how long with her? How I walked up on you two at our favorite restaurant? How could you take her there? At this point, she was right in Jameer's face, close enough to punch him in the eye so he could feel a smidgen of the pain she had endured for the past year. Stone-cold resolve took the place of any lingering sadness she'd been carrying around like a dead weight. I can't believe I let what he did to me take so much control over my life. Not anymore. You know what? I don't have time for this. Whatever you had planned, you can dead that right now. Get your shit and get the hell away from my... No, get the hell away from the front of my apartment. Sylvia, now. She pointed toward the end of the street for emphasis. And there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. That's insane. How the fuck he thought he was gonna come back? Hold on, y'all. Sorry, it's 4:44 and I noticed it. My ancestors in the building. All right. The renovations for the barbershop were complete. Dontrell and Roland were beyond excited. Nigga, I am quitting my job today, Roland said, sliding into his usual seat at Checkers. Hold your horses. We ain't moved in yet, Dontrell said, though he had already envisioned himself handing in his own 2-week notice. Already got my speech planned. I'ma go straight up to Mark's old Where's Waldo looking ass and tell him I'm done. Then I'ma visit each one of those uppity supervisors' office so I can provide them with their own personal fuck you. You crazy. Dontrell took a sip of his drink, and that reminded him of what Sylvia told him about her friend Katina's idea for a non-alcoholic bar. Yo, maybe we should invite your girl Sylvia to our grand opening party, Roland said, as if he was reading Dontrell's mind. Shit, she ain't my girl. He pushed his drink away, suddenly losing interest. What happened? She got a man. What makes you think that? I dropped her off the other day, and the nigga was sitting outside on her porch. Maybe he was her ex or something. Nah, she ain't even say nothing to me before she got out the car. Damn, I mean, maybe shit between them ain't really serious. Look like it to me, but fuck it. I'm trying to focus on making this money. Right. Roland wanted to say more, but he just left it alone. Yeah, that's the smart thing to do, Roland. Leave it the fuck alone. Sylvia could not wait to get to Katina's house to tell her what happened with Jameer. She hopped out of her Uber and strode up to Katina's door. It opened before she could even knock. Girl, let me tell you, said Katina. Shit, let me tell you first. Katina blinked in response. What happened? She closed the door as Sylvia made her way over to Katina's couch. She plopped down and rolled her eyes, preparing to launch into her story. So tell me why Dontrell picked me up from Yvonne's office the other day.
Ooh.
Ooh, Katina's eyes lit up as she sat down next to her. Wait, let me get our drinks first. I made a new recipe and I am dying for you to try it. She hopped up and practically skipped to her kitchen. When she returned, she handed Sylvia her drink before sitting down. Sylvia took a sip and her eyes widened. Wow, Katina, this is really good. You are truly talented. It was a fruity drink that she could tell was blended with some other ingredients, but Sylvia could never pinpoint exactly what was in a mixed drink. Thank you, girl, Katina gushed, but enough about my excellent mixology skills. Tell me what happened with Don Trail and his fine ass. Listen, so we're having a really good conversation, and I think he's about to ask for my number or something, but then we get to my house and Jameer is sitting outside on my front steps. Katina's eyes widened in shock. No! Yes, Jameer's sitting there like I'm late or something, and he's all impatient, and he's got his suitcase and a backpack with him. What? Yes, that fool had his suitcase and a backpack sitting there on the steps next to him like he's some sad little orphan child thinking I'm gonna take him in, and he's about to just pick up where he left off because Veronica dumped his ass. This nigga. Katina rolled her eyes at Jameer's antics and took another sip of her drink. So what happened next? Girl, I wanted to throw his stupid ass suitcase in the middle of the street. How dare he think he can do what he did and then just come back like nothing happened? Did you cuss him out? Hell yeah. I told his ass to get away from my porch and not come back. At first, he acted like he wasn't trying to leave. But once he saw I was serious, he finally bounced. I really can't believe him. Wow, me either. So what about Don Trail? Did he say anything? Did he see you guys arguing? No, and that's the worst part. I think he thought Jameer was my man because he sped out of there before I could say anything. Oh no, honey, we gonna have to fix this. I don't know how though. We don't even have each other's numbers. Huh. Katina flipped her hair back like Sylvia wasn't saying nothing but a thing. She whipped out her cell phone and brought up his social media page. How did you find him? Sylvia was amazed. Mama got ways. Clearly, but you really think I should send him a friend request, though? Sylvia sounded doubtful, but she was already typing his first and last name into her own search bar. Yes, but I don't want to come across the wrong way. How would you come across the wrong way? I don't know. Sylvia shook her head and put down her phone like it had just bitten her hand. I have to think about it. Girl, if you don't send that request, I'll think about it. I might do it later. Ugh. Katina palmed her forehead. I don't know what I'm gonna do with you. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, the way I'd have been like, oh, okay, hold on, let me run in here right quick. Okay. Let me run in here right quick, motherfucker, and get something for you. And the way I would have ran in there and got the blucka blucka and just start letting shit off, you got me fucked up. Shit. Think you gonna come to my spot and you got major attitude after you cheated on me? Man, fuck you. Fuck, nigga. Raggedy ass buster. That's what we used to call them back in the day. Busters or buster ass niggas.
Here comes the money.
Here we go. Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
Thank you, Akira, for the tip. And she said, for your amazing vibe. Thank you, darling. I appreciate you. Thank you so much. And now, the way his ass would have got fucking lit up by me, I don't give a fuck. Fucking asshole. No God.
Here comes the money.
Here we go. Money talk.
Here comes the money.
I'm gonna beat your ass, sweet November. Thank you for the tip. She said, for therapy for the rubber band phobia with three laughing emojis. Y'all ain't shit, boy. Y'all be giving me grief like a mug. I swear y'all do. What the hell? I am far behind on the live stream. Damn. All right. Thank both of you ladies for the tip. I appreciate y'all. Thank you so much. Not for the rubber band phobia. Boy, y'all be hard on a bitch. Okay, it's all right, though. I got you. I got you. It's funny. Till it ain't. Oh, boy. All right. Now, let me get this damn timestamp so we can finish this up. And that way, I can think about whether or not I'm going to come back. Because if y'all going to be treating me like a bald-head scoochie rat that ain't got no hair in the back, I be damn. I wasn't expecting this shit to take fucking 3 hours, but whatever, child. All right, so here we go. Chapter 5. Dontrell and Roland were at Checkers finalizing their plans for the grand opening party. Free haircuts for college students and kids under 18. Discounts for adults, music and food, but they were still debating about that. So, now that we got the dates set, we need to set some dates, Roland said, his sly grin showing that he was enjoying his clever wordplay. And Dontrell knew exactly where he was going with this. I already told you, man, she got somebody. But you don't know that for sure. Man, listen, I am not about to get played twice. I got enough of that shit with Samia or Samaya, whatever. I told y'all, I be fucking these people names up. What happened to regular fucking names? Like Saki and Jane and Joyce and, I don't know, Teresa or Linda or Wanda. Like, what the fuck? Anyway, speaking of, has she tried to hit you up since that night? A few times, but I let her know I wasn't having it. I don't see myself going back to nobody that cheated on me. Preach. So, what about you? Who you bringing? Oh, I'm all set, Roland smirked. All set, huh? Dontrell eyed him suspiciously, wondering what his friend was cooking up now. Yup. So, anyway, I finally handed in my 2-week notice yesterday. Did you do yours yet? I ain't handing him shit. I'm walking my black ass out on the last day and never looking back, Dontrell chuckled. You wildin'. No, nobody wildin'. They've been giving me their ass to kiss since I started with the company. Now it's my turn to return the favor. Dontrell couldn't argue with that. Roland's boss was always hounding him about something petty, just like his boss at the pizza shop did to him for no reason except that he could, because he was the boss. Well, I'm about to be my own boss now, he said to himself with a smile. Nigga, we really about to do this. Dontrell's eyes gleamed with excitement. I almost can't believe it myself. And there's a break in the chapter. Sylvia stood at the bus stop waiting to go to the grocery store. She decided against taking an Uber because she didn't want to risk being paired with Dontrell again. She knew it was silly because there were so many drivers out there, but she didn't want to chance it. I'll just get a few things and see if Katina can bring me to get more later. The bus was set to arrive in 10 minutes. Child, if you think I'm about to get my black ass on a bus just to avoid seeing a motherfucker, you got me fucked up. She pulled her earbuds out of her pocket and prepared to listen to her music when a car stopped directly in front of her in the street. She squinted as the window rolled down. She recognized Roland from the open mic night. Hey, you need a ride somewhere? She didn't want to be rude, so she obliged. Thank you. I'm just headed to the grocery store on Brown Street. Hope that's not too far out your way. Shit, I just quit my job. I got all the time in the world today. Hop in. Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. Sylvia opened the door and settled herself in the front passenger seat. Because I'm thinking, is she going to get in the back like it's a fucking Uber? I'm not sorry, said Roland. I couldn't wait to get away from that place. Oh, yeah, I remember now. You guys are opening a barbershop, right? Roland's face broke out in a huge smile. Yep, we are having a grand opening party next weekend. You should come. I'll line you up. He grinned at her. Boy, stop, she said, pushing his shoulder slightly. For such a multi-talented individual, Roland was really cool, not at all conceited or full of himself like a lot of talented guys were. They chatted about various things on the way to the store, and she felt like she was talking to an old friend. He would be really good for Katina, she thought, noticing the many similarities in their personalities. When they got to the store, Roland said he had to pick up a few things too, so he might as well shop with her, then drop her off back home afterward. She was totally shocked, but grateful she wouldn't have to carry all that stuff on the bus. Child, you better stock up for the next 6 months, bitch, while you got a ride. His shit finna be weighted down with the muffler creating sparks. Lord have mercy. Anyway, when they got back in the car, Roland eased into what was really on his mind. So, what's up with you and my boy Dontrell? Y'all kicking it or what? Oh, I don't know. She didn't know how much she should say. She looked out the window and pretended to be fascinated with the scenery. What's up? I think he may have some wrong ideas about me. Oh, really? How so? She explained to him what happened when Dontrell dropped her off and how he saw Jameer sitting outside waiting for her. Jameer? Is he the same Jameer that hang with Rex and them? She nodded. Yup, I know that nigga. He sucked his teeth. It's fucked up he dogged you out. Thanks for caring. Oh, no doubt, but I definitely think you should holler at my boy Don Frail. He's a good dude, for real. She slid him a sidelong glance. You sure you're not just saying that because he's your boy? Nope, Don Frail is the faithful type. He's never cheated once. Wow, I didn't think men like that existed anymore. Well, they do, and Don Frail is one of them. I trust him with my life, and he's my business partner. That's as real as it gets, making decisions about money and building a business together. You've got a point there, she admitted. They pulled up in front of her duplex. Well, thank you for the ride. Anytime. Roland hopped out of the car to help her bring her groceries to the door. And think about what I said earlier, he said, before she went inside. Don Trail is a good dude, for real. I will, she waved as he drove away. Child, listen. And there's a break in the chapter. Don Trail was scrolling his timeline when he sat in a parking lot waiting for a hit for a new ride. He paused when he saw Sylvia's name pop up as a suggested friend. I wonder how that happened. They didn't have any mutual friends. He hesitated, then shot her a request. If she rejects it, then whatever. He continued to scroll mindlessly, almost ready to be done driving for the day when he got a hit for a ride that was 4 minutes away. He closed out the app, but not before he saw that Sylvia had accepted his request. Later that night, he found himself on her page. He looked at all her pictures, each one more beautiful than the last. Damn, she bad. Then he scrolled down her wall to read her posts. He noticed that a lot of them were really short and kind of depressing. Damn, she really must be going through some things. Before he realized it, he got down to a post about her accident. There was a picture of her car. His eyes widened at the damage. No wonder she has PTSD. He continued to scroll beyond that to her post before the accident, and he noticed they were a lot longer, happier, and more full of life. It was then that he realized the extent of the trauma she had suffered and the long-term effects it had caused. It was like her whole persona had changed after that wreck. She got to get back on the road. He closed out the app and thought about her for a few moments before setting off to pick up his next ride. He had to find a way to help her. And that's the end of that chapter. All right, so we about to start the last chapter, y'all. And it's not that long. But that's all right. So, let me wet my whistle. I see that damn cat outside again. done stuck around for the whole time. Because he or she, I don't know if it's a girl or a boy cat. Don't start me to lie. But y'all, they be outside. It was out there before I went live. Chapter 6. Sylvia got up off the couch and went to the front door to get some air. As soon as she opened it, she jumped in startled surprise when she saw Don Trail standing there, his hand poised to knock. Hey, she said. Hey, how are you? He shifted on his feet. I'm good. What are you doing here? She crossed her arms because she didn't know what else to do with her hands. I came to see you. To see me? Her eyes widened. Yeah, I know it's been a struggle for you, and I want to help you get back on the road. Back on the road? Her mind began swimming as she registered what he was trying to say. Yeah, I figured maybe we could go around the block. Sylvia needed to breathe. She could already feel her heart racing. A flashback of the truck's headlights bearing down on her entered her mind, and she fought to blink it back. She felt nauseous. Oh, Don Trail, I'm not sure I can do that. Listen, I don't want to pressure you, but I believe you can. You said it's been a year, right? Yes, but every time I even think about it, I get flashbacks. Like it happened right now. As soon as you said that, I don't think I can do this. I feel weak. How about if we just sit in the car first, just to get you back in the driver's seat? She blew out a deep breath as her body trembled at the thought. I've been trying to get to the point where I can do that for over a month. Her voice cracked at the end of her sentence. He reached out and gently touched her arm. You don't have to be nervous. I'm right here with you. And why should I trust you? Her mind screamed. You could be just like Jamia, despite what your boy Roland says. Come on. He laid his hand gently in the crook of her arm and guided her down the steps and to her car. Do you have your keys? Yes, I mean, not on me. They're in the house. I can't believe this is happening. Am I really going to do this? Wait here a moment. She made her way back up to her door, grabbed the keys from the key holder, and locked her apartment. She made her way back to where Dontrell was standing in front of her car. Her legs felt like they could give way at any moment. You ready? She swallowed, but her mouth felt dry. Not really. It's going to be okay. He took the keys from her and popped the lock. How about you sit in the driver's seat? He opened the door and gestured for her to walk toward him. She took a deep breath and silenced the negative thoughts intruding her mind. She held his outstretched hand and took baby steps toward the driver's seat. She finally sat down and put on her seatbelt as Dontrell locked the door. Her breathing became slightly more labored when she glanced in the rearview mirror. Dontrell sat in the front passenger seat and handed her the keys after he closed the door. Don't be nervous. I got you. She felt herself starting to sweat. I don't know, Dontrell. This is huge. I know. But you can do this. How about you just turn the key in the ignition? We don't have to drive. Just turn the key. She licked her lips and tried to calm her breathing as she put the key in the ignition and turned it. She startled as the engine revved to life. Tears filled her eyes. Oh my God, I can't believe I'm doing this. You got this. Dontrell smiled at her. They sat there for a few moments, listening to the engine hum. Dontrell noticed she seemed a bit calmer now. You want to try backing out of the parking space? Her heart pounded at the prospect, but she knew that if she had come this far, she had to try. Okay, she said, and put the car in reverse. And then there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. Well, he's very patient, because I'd have been like, shit, take a Uber, bitch, because I don't want you to have no flashback and then end up ramming us into another fucking vehicle because you clicking on Superman lunchbox crazy. No, God. Crazy. All right. As soon as Sylvia got back into her apartment after Dontrell left, she had jumped up and down with excitement. I have to call Katina. She grabbed her phone and called her friend. What's up, girl? I drove. Oh my God, Katina, I did it. She practically screamed in her ear. You what? I drove, Katina. I drove my car today. What? How? When did this happen? Just now. Dontrell came to my house and pushed me to get in the car. Dontrell did that. Ooh, girl, I'm on my way over. Okay, see you soon. Sylvia practically skipped to her kitchen to prepare some snacks. Katina arrived 5 minutes quicker than it usually took her to get to Sylvia's apartment. Sylvia flung her door open with a huge smile on her face. Girl, that was fast. I couldn't waste any juicy details. Katina assessed Sylvia. Girl, I'm so proud of you. Sylvia couldn't stop smiling. I know. I can't believe I did it. Sylvia clasped her hands in front of her chest as the tears filled her eyes. I totally wasn't expecting him to come over to my house to help me drive. I mean, all I did was get up off the couch to open the door for some fresh air, and there he stood, ready to help me. That was so sweet. I know. I have to get him a gift or something. You have no idea how long I've wanted to do this. I feel you, girl. I'm so happy for you. And there's another break in the chapter. Sylvia and Katina walked up to Dontrell and Roland's barbershop, ready to join the party. Sylvia clutched Dontrell's gift bag in her hands. She hoped he liked it. They were greeted by Dontrell and Roland as soon as they entered. Ladies, said Roland as they all exchanged hugs. Welcome to our humble abode. The place was packed. People were coming in to take pictures with Dontrell and Roland, to get haircuts, and to sign their welcome board. Steve and Rail were there with their girlfriends, Gia and Centrell. Listen, it's too many goddamn trails and rails and listen. Katina and Sylvia signed their congratulations on the board and mingled with the rest of Roland's crew, enjoying the festive atmosphere, the music, and the spread of food on a table set up in the back. Dontrell and Roland had gotten a few local barbers to come in and help out, and they were working hard to serve all the kids who came for free cuts. Sylvia admired how careful Dontrell was with his cuts and how he tried to make every kid feel special. When he finally got a break, she asked to speak with him briefly outside so that she could give him his gift. When they got outside, she felt nervous. I got you a gift, she said, her heart pounding as she handed him the bag. She pushed her hair behind her ear as he opened the box containing some gold-plated clippers with his company name and logo engraved on them. His eyes widened. Wow, you did this for me? She blushed. Yeah, I wanted to congratulate you and to thank you. Wow, Sylvia, he repeated, staring at the gift, then back at her. I've never had a woman do anything like this for me. Well, I truly appreciate what you did for me the other day. Oh, I was happy to help. Seeing you relaxed and smiling behind the wheel was enough of a reward, but these clippers are amazing. They stared at each other, not sure what to say next. Sylvia turned to head back inside, but Dontrell stepped closer to her and they were inches apart. Wait, where you going? He spoke in a low, smooth voice that was only loud enough for her to hear. Her heart practically beat out of her chest as she looked up at his chin, then into his gorgeous eyes. He lowered his head down to hers and their eyes closed as their lips locked in a sweet kiss. They pulled apart in nervous hesitation, then went in for more. Dontrell wrapped his arms around her waist and she wrapped her arms around his neck. Both of them were so lost in the moment that they almost forgot where they were. When they pulled apart again, Dontrell felt eyes on him and glanced toward the barbershop. There stood Roland and Katina at the window, grinning. Oh, my gosh, lurking asses, Sylvia laughed, and moments later, Roland and Katina joined them outside. So, seems like you two have finally gotten acquainted, said Katina, smirking at Dontrell and Sylvia, then smiling up at Roland. We did it, bae, said Roland. Dontrell and Sylvia's heads snapped at the same time. Bae, they said in unison. Roland flashed a sheepish grin. Yeah, son, we've been kicking it since the open mic. Sylvia gasped. You little sneak! She playfully swatted Katina's arm. Girl, it was so hard to hold it in around you. I couldn't wait to tell, but I was trying to wait till you and Dontrell finally got together. You two are a trip, said Dontrell, looking back and forth between Roland and Katina, made for each other. So, right for each other, Sylvia echoed, chuckling at the revelation. So, anyways, how about a double date after the grand opening is over? Roland and Katina glanced at each other. Sounds good to me, said Roland, and they all headed back inside to enjoy the rest of the party. And then, there's another break in the chapter, y'all. 1 year later, Dontrell and Sylvia stood outside the building with the rest of the crowd of excited onlookers as Katina prepared to cut the ribbon to her brand new establishment, Lily's. Her dream had finally come true. She was opening a non-alcoholic bar in remembrance of her cousin. She gave Roland, who was now her fiancé, a quick kiss on the lips for good luck. She picked up the big scissors and pretended they were too heavy for her to everyone's amusement, then took a deep breath and cut the red ribbon. The crowd erupted in applause as the ribbon fell to the floor. Her family members and some of Lily's close friends released some red balloons in the air as a tribute. Everyone made their way to the doors as the security guards held them open. Sylvia and Dontrell mingled with a few people in the crowded bar before they made their way over to Katina and Roland as Katina talked to a news reporter about her plans for the establishment. Yes, we plan to serve non-alcoholic beverages only, as well as host dance parties for the youth and emerging adult population, she explained. We also plan to host events at high schools and colleges as part of a community effort to discourage drinking and driving amongst youth and young adults. When the interview was over, Roland squeezed her hand and gave her a hug and another kiss. When they pulled away from their embrace, Katina turned to Sylvia. Girl, we didn't keep you on your feet too long, did we? No, girl, I'm good. You know I wouldn't miss this for the world. Sylvia smiled and rubbed her pregnant belly. Life had changed so much since she had met Dontrell. They had gotten married earlier that year, and now they were looking forward to their first child. Her sessions with Yvonne had ceased, but once her therapy was over, she, Yvonne, and Katina had hung out a few times, and they really hit it off, just like Sylvia knew they would. Shit, we need to hurry up and get like y'all, said Roland, starting families and shit. He grinned. Dontrell chuckled, nigga, it's only a matter of months for y'all. Just have the wedding after Sylvia has the baby. She don't want her going into labor on the dance floor. I second that, said Sylvia, and Katina chimed in with, please, I don't want any water breaking during my reception. Everyone laughed again. Ain't it crazy how life turns out, though, said Roland. Dontrell smiled. Shoot, who you telling? And that's the end, y'all. So, I liked it. I don't know if y'all liked it, but I liked it. I did, y'all. I thought it was good. Okay, Tanisha, girl. Okay. I'm trying to I don't even know what the fuck I did with it. All right, hold on. Let me shut up, wifey. Oh, child, a buck gonna get a whooping. All right, hold on. Let me I need to get the synopsis for the damn books, child. Where's the damn thing at? Because this thing is a part of a DVD box set. Shout out to those of y'all that know where that come from. Okay, let me see if I can get the your dig from here. All right, because so there's two of the where's the other one at? All right. So now, here we go. Let me read y'all for these two fucking things. All right, so the first one is it's called A Husband, A Boyfriend, and a Side Dude, and it's by Tanisha too. All right, so the synopsis on that one is Sienna and her husband Trent are nearing their sixth anniversary of marriage. Ever since they said I do, their romance was like a whirlwind. That is, until Sienna's first secret, then her second. Life is going crazy, and things are starting to get real. Tensions continue to rise until Sienna is placed in a situation where she has to make a choice between the one she truly loves and the one she's not sure about. Okay? So, now that one is... Hold on. It ain't telling me, damn it. Hold on. I'm about to tell you how many pages it is. It's only 55 pages, okay? Mm-hmm. So that's a cute little skippity-pap, right? Then, let me get y'all the other one. All right, now this one is by Tanisha as well, but it's a little supposed to be a little short little thing, but I don't know that we'll get through the whole you dig today, which is why I'll start this one second. But it's a compilation of three different books that have been revamped by the author and compiled into a special edition, right? So she added some more scenes. And apparently a little bit of extra stuff since the originals came out. So I'm thinking that this might be better. All right, so it's called Betrayed, and it's a series of books. So let me just read y'all the synopsis, okay? So it says, what is Betrayed series special edition? Listen, your mama is a bald-headed scallywag. How did you go away like that? Motherfucker. Sorry. Okay. Okay. Readers love the Betrayed series so much that Tanisha Stewart has decided to release a special edition. In this book, all three of the stories in the Betrayed series are presented, along with added content, including the infamous barbecue scene, as well as more background information on Kelvin, Ileana, Kaysean, which I'm thinking has to be Kayshawn. And if it ain't, that's what I'm going to call his ass. I don't know if that's a girl or a man. But anyway, and June. If you enjoy the original books, you don't want to miss these updates. Follow the story of the betrayal June endured. Keep your friends close and your enemies closer. All right, so now let me read you the, it's three different synopses here. So book one is called Betrayed by My So-Called Friend. June is in an online relationship with the man of her dreams, Jermaine. He's the first person she met that seemed to know her before they ever even spoke. Although they've never met in person, she is sure he is the one. But there's only one problem. Her beloved Jermaine isn't real. She's being catfished by someone very close to her, someone she thought she could trust. Now, there are two other books, okay, that are included. But if I read the synopses for those two books, that's going to give it away. And I ain't going to do that. All right? Yeah, not going to do that. But I'm going to keep it all together because it's one big book. Yeah, wifey. Mm-hmm. Yep. All right, so I got to think about it. Not calling her Kool-Aid spot a bar. Oh my God, Buck. I cannot with you. You so fucking bad. Oh my God. A mess. Okay. All right. So yeah, I really, I'm hoping y'all enjoy these. So I gotta, yeah, that's my time stamp papers. So I'm thinking, because it's 5:18, I don't know, y'all be having to go to work in the morning, child. And so it might take us a little bit of time, child, to finish this shit. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to start with the other book, the fucking, because that one is just four chapters. I'm going to start with the husband, a wife, and a side dude. Okay, so I'm going to start with that one. And the reason being is because that one is supposed to take less than an hour to read. And then that way, if we get into the other books and we can't finish, then, you know, we can stop there, right? And it still makes sense because it's all three the same. All three of them are betrayed books. So, yeah. That's what I think I'll do. All right. So, it's 5:20. I'm going to shut the fuck up and get out of here if I'm going to come back. I know you work at night, wifey, but all the rest of these folks here, I know you work at night. I wasn't worried about you, right? Because you don't mind, you know what I'm saying? But I'm talking about, I'm talking about everybody else, child. Because these folks be having to get their butts up and wash their nuts and their twats and, you know, get on down the road to get to work and shit. And so I don't, you know, I don't want to, child, I said nuts and twats. Oh, Jesus Christ. Anyway, y'all know what the fuck I'm talking about. All right, so I'm going to get out of here. All right, and I'll set the thumbnail, however long it takes me to put it together. Hopefully not long, but yeah, I got to get some shit scraculating right quick so that I can at least give y'all a couple of hours when I come back. So I'm trying to come back at like 6:30 my time. That's 7:30 out there on the East Coast. 5:30 if you're in the mountains and 4:30 if you out there in weirdo land on the West Coast, okay? All right. So listen, I appreciate each and every one of you coming through and listening to me read out loud, and I hope I left you feeling better than you were when you got here. Thank you so much, Love Jones, for all of your wonderful, wonderful help. All right, you guys. So listen, y'all be looking out for the damn, for the thumbnail, okay? And of course, I'll alert y'all over on, I'm about to say over on YouTube, over on Instagram, right? And hopefully, if I'm able to get everything in order, I'll be able to come back a little bit sooner. But don't hold me to that. So be looking for me to come back about 6:30. All right? So in like an hour. All right? Okay? So I love y'all. Y'all be safe. And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye, y'all. Why are y'all still here? Go on now. Bye, y'all.